and we move forward into elections. The decision topic, since the last page, last segment of page one. And we were having discussions about preliminary elections, runoff elections, signature requirements, and IRB. Maddie, you were doing some homework for us.
I did. I called Ms. Mazza, who's here, so now I feel like I'm violating hearsay law by saying what she said when she's here. But I asked her about, how, so just interrupt me, Wendy, if I can tell you.
Okay.
I asked her about how quickly she could hold an election after another election, and she said that that in the current charter, I guess the maximum is 42 days, and that feels like the bare minimum. There's some mechanical things that just have to do with the printing of ballots and programming of the voting machines, which have to be done in Nebraska. They have to be shipped to Nebraska. Then when they come back, they have to obviously be tested. But then there's some more pretty significant hurdles beyond mechanical, which is that absentee ballots, people have 3 weeks to submit absentee ballots before an election. There's also the 20 days before an election to register to vote. So I think there's probably some other things in there, but it seemed to me by what she was saying there was, and those things are the registering to vote and absentee ballots and application for an absentee ballot for someone with the status of a permanent disability. Those things are all heavily controlled by state statute, and they're not at all flexible. So, moreover, the staffing capacity in her office, they already are doing more than they're technically staffed to do. So she didn't, she felt like 42 days was the maximum. What I tried to really understand, which was what is the difference between two elections being a preliminary and a general election versus a general election and a runoff election afterwards? And, are those just a mirror image of impact on her office? And she felt that they were not at all equal in terms of the administrative burden because many, many times, first of all, they don't have a preliminary election. And then other times when they are charged with holding a preliminary election, they're not citywide. So the preliminary election is rarely a full force election like the general election. So she felt like, that would be, just a double the cost, it would be so much impact. She did say in her opinion that she thought we could do away with preliminary elections, that a general election was sufficient, and that the idea of a plurality, she wasn't impressed by that based on the low voter turnout and sort of the national and international trend towards accepting coalition governments and stuff.
Do you want to recognize her to speak? You have to have a motion to do that, just so we would. Is there any reason that you'd like to hear directly from this?
Wendy, would you like to speak to this issue? Or?
Sure.
Okay, we need a motion to that. I'll take a second. All in favor?
Aye.
And Wendy, please.
Thank you. The reason I'm not in favor of having another election 42 days after the general election first of all, is the amount of work that it entails to just do one election. And if I had an office staff of, you know, maybe five more people, that would be wonderful. I would probably entertain it and say yes. I guess my feeling on the whole thing is that you can't get people out to vote no matter what you do. I mean, if a voter's going to vote, they're going to vote. And regardless of what you do to change the voting scenario here in Northampton, it's not going to change the voter status one bit. I've been in the office for 40 years. I've seen it happen that I can tell you during a municipal election that generally, unless there is a money issue on the ballot that is actually going to affect a person's pocketbook, you are not going to see a huge voter turnout. And I don't care what you do with voter, how you want to regulate elections. I would hope that when you're regulating elections, that you're going to regulate them to the fact that you're going to get more people to run for office and not less people to run for office. As you saw in this election, we couldn't even get school committee members to come. We couldn't get anybody to run for school committee. I was begging for somebody to come for Ward 2. So with that in mind, I think you really have to think of what's the easiest process for people to come and want to be on a ballot, run an election that's efficient and above board, and not complicate the matters any more than you really have to complicate them. I think that our elections in Northampton run well. I don't think that we have a problem with them. I just think that people are just, I think they're disenfranchised with local government, period. And I just don't think they're interested in it. And so that's only my take on it. I mean, and certainly you may have a different outlook on it, and that's fine.
Are you in favor of eliminating the preliminary
election? I am in favor of eliminating the preliminary election because, you know, most of the time you have one or two candidates that are running, and if it's in a ward seat, you're opening up a precinct. I'm hiring these people for that one, as we did, you know, with Owen at that time. And it was still costly to do that. I have to do the same amount of work for one ward as I would for an entire city election. It doesn't change. The process doesn't change at all.
And are you concerned that then there'd be, if there's three candidates, like for a mayoral, and then there's a split in there, all in the 30s, nobody has a 51%?
I go by the highest vote getter. That's what I'm going by. I'm not going by percentage. I mean, if you're going to go by percentage, you're going to have a difficult time with that. It was an anomaly for David to get 71% this time, but we only had 48% of registered voters come out and vote. So, I mean, you know, if you're going to do anything, you want to be able to have the fact of getting more registered voters out to vote versus looking at a candidate getting 51% of the total vote. I mean, that's the issue for me. I mean, you're putting that kind of work into an election, and it takes you 42 days to get an election up and running. I have to hire 350 election workers to work the polls. That doesn't happen overnight. And for to have 48% of the registered voters come and only vote for an election that was having a new mayor for the first time in 12 years, it was only 48%. So, I mean, the issue is, how do you get them out there to vote? What makes them interested to come out and vote? What do you do to get candidates that are interested to run? It's not so much of changing that you have another election in 42 days. That, I mean, what does that prove? If you're interested in running to vote, if you're interested in running for an election, you're going to do what's necessary to do it. You're going to go, you're going to get your nomination papers, you're going to file, get your signatures, you're going to file your nomination papers, and you're going to go out and you're going to start campaigning if you are really interested in the position, and you're going to do your platform. Another election, I mean, it's just, I don't know. I don't understand the logic in that at all.
Todd?
I guess I was a little bit confused with your remarks about whether you thought a runoff was going to be more work than a preliminary. I think just a little background where we're coming from, we were trying to figure out how to make the general election as inclusive as possible without having it, say you have three or four candidates, without necessarily having the cost of a preliminary election to winnow it down to two.
So when you say inclusive as possible, what do you mean by that? I mean, anybody is able to run for an election, so that's inclusive.
Well, currently our understanding is if there are four candidates that file for mayor, then you'll have to have a preliminary election
to
narrow it down to two.
That's
even
correct.
Though three of those candidates could only, in aggregate, get 15%.
That's the way you're looking at it, yes.
Okay,
I understand.
That's hypothetical, mm-hmm, right. In which case, if you didn't have the prelim and you had a runoff, mm-hmm, you would need a runoff in that situation. You'd have an open general election for
right.
everybody.
Everybody would go on the ballot in November, and the voters would vote. They would have their opportunity to have all of their debates and set their platforms, and then come November, whoever received the highest number of votes would be the mayor. You're putting an undue advantage on someone else that's going to have an opportunity, that if it's the third candidate, to go out there and continue an election to see, because they didn't receive 51% of the votes. I'm old school when it comes to election, I guess. I don't know.
The market. Yeah.
The idea of instant runoff voting was a way of avoiding having to do a preliminary, but from an earlier correspondence,
right? We can't. We're not allowed to do that in Massachusetts.
There was an issue with the setup of the voting machine.
We also have to have permission from the Secretary of the Commonwealth.
Okay.
To do that.
Well, we already have some municipalities. Cambridge has a form of instant runoff voting right now.
Well, they may.
So there seems to be some means by which a municipality could get that permission.
But for me to do that would mean to have to retrofit all the machines, and I'd have to buy a whole nother program that's physically located in my office in order to do that, which is absolutely too costly. These machines will probably be replaced within the next 2 years.
Well, what about beyond that then? Are you foreseeing, would you imagine that the city's next acquisition of voting equipment would be something that would more easily allow?
It probably would, because it would be more it would meet the federal standards, and it would probably be a machine that would probably be able to do that. Yes.
Well, is your sense that the biggest impediment to instant runoff voting in the city is the technical abilities of the equipment?
No, I mean, it has nothing to do with the technical abilities. It's the cost to retrofit them, number one. I don't see the purpose of it. I really don't. I don't see the purpose of instant runoff voting.
Well, let me just understand, though. You're saying that the city needs, that the idea of replacing the current voting equipment in a couple of years, is that because of just
it doesn't meet the federal guidelines. Right now, Massachusetts has got a waiver.
Okay.
The federal government has given Massachusetts a waiver to continue to use the Optic 3P Eagles because they don't meet the federal Help America Vote Act. And after this presidential election, they're more than likely going to tell us that we have to buy new machines.
Is that like ADA compliance issues?
No. It's just there's certain criteria that they don't meet, and Massachusetts has been able to get a waiver for that. And right now, I have a capital improvement of $100,000 for new voting machines, if it happens. But the state has not approved any new voting machines. I can't just go out and purchase them. The state has to.
I would say in a couple of years, the state did approve new voting machines. Is your understanding that those new voting machines?
Yes, I don't have any understanding of it. I don't know what they are.
All right.
I can't answer that.
But is it conceivable that Northampton would get voting machines?
I guess anything is conceivable. I mean, I just don't know what the I don't know what the state is going to certify. That all these machines go to the state and they pick one and they certify it. So I have no idea.
Okay, but just to answer your question about what was the benefit. I mean, the benefit is the one that you've noted, that the instrument of voting would avoid the cost and effort of having to run a second preliminary or runoff election, a separate one. There would be no additional cost. And if the city is going to get equipment anyway in the future that does allow it, I mean, why not at that point? Would it be worthwhile to consider the idea when the equipment is able to support instrument of voting, that that's when you would...
I think once we buy new equipment, maybe at that point you could address it. But at this point, I don't think that I would. I mean, I'm not going to certainly entertain it at this point. I mean, I'm not going to agree to that because I don't know enough about it. I don't know enough about instant runoff voting to even make a decision whether I like it or not. And I've reached out to my other clerks, and not one clerk in Massachusetts knows anything about instant runoff voting.
Well, it's an academic issue. If the equipment doesn't support it right now, then it's not
really
capable.
Yeah.
In deliberating about this, we've tried to look at the point of view of a lot of different people, mm-hmm. and the city clerk was one, and, mm-hmm. and it's really useful to us to get this information from him. We also tried to look at the candidate's perspective, so that somebody very new to the election process, without mm-hmm. a lot of money, without being known in town, would have sort of an equal chance in terms of the amount of time to mount a campaign that somebody with more assets or resources would have. We also looked at it from the point of view of the voters, mm-hmm. Where it's disconcerting to a person in a democratic jurisdiction to feel like they can't vote for their really favorite person because that person has so little chance, and so they're kind of forced into a narrower field. We also looked at it from the point of view of the winner. That mm-hmm. is, if you win an election with only a marginal plurality, mm-hmm. you know, highest vote but very low.
Percentage-wise, you're talking
percentage
about.
But very near to the amount, the number of votes of your of the other candidates, mm-hmm. then you never have that sense that you have been given a mandate to run your program. So it's difficult to govern that way. So these are just some of the things that we've been thinking about mm-hmm. that make us think about the timing, the number of elections, and which ones to use. Are any of those concerns, now that I've sort of spelled them out, do any of them change your thinking in any way?
No. Because I still believe that if the nomination papers are out there by April 2nd, a candidate, if they're interested in running to vote, and they're serious about it, once they start getting their nomination papers out there, getting their signatures, get them filed with me, that's the point when they mount their campaign, regardless of whether they have $0 or they have $10,000. I mean, if they're interested in running, then that is their responsibility to make sure that they're out there and they're making themselves known. I mean, that's the process. I mean, I don't know what else to say to you. I mean, it's been that way. I mean, and I'm not saying that it's probably right, but I've never heard a candidate tell me otherwise and never complained otherwise about the election process in Northampton. I mean, every one of them has an opportunity to form a committee, and every one of them has an opportunity to have fundraisers and collect money. So I don't understand that. I mean, I don't feel that they're disenfranchised in any way. I mean, if they're disenfranchised, it's because they've done it themselves. It has nothing to do with the electoral process. It's they've chosen not to do those particular processes. So
one
I mean,
of
that's
I'm purposely updating not only the city clerk, who's in charge of voting, but also Mark, that we have put on the floor yesterday as a discussion item, specifically around IRV, was to if you will, in a sense, table it and ask that the City Council form a commission to look at voting issues over the next period of time. That might coincide with the new voting machine mm-hmm. piece of it, but to look at should there be IRV voting as an option for Northampton and to pull it out from the charter, to sort of listen to what proponents of IRV said for the public hearings, which was good concept, maybe we need to hold off on that until and hold that as a separate issue as opposed to too much change that might be, if you will, that poison pill for the charter. So that was something that was put on the table. There's no agreement to it. It was just something that was put on the table as a way to move the discussion forward. Other issues or questions for the city clerk? Okay.
Thanks. Thank you. Is there going to be public comment during this meeting?
I will ask for public comment. I just want to get this done while Wendy's
okay.
here, so thanks. Other questions or issues in this area? Okay. I will take a break since I did neglect to bring up. I'm sorry. Did you have raising?
No. Does that mean we're going to? I assume we're going to continue this discussion.
We're going to continue this discussion, but I do want to take that formal break because I'm sorry. Thank you for reminding me. You should have waved earlier. We open each meeting with public comment. Is there anyone from the floor who would like to have public comment?
You can go. Okay. Can I ask questions to your experts?
The usual way public comment is that you comment and then
okay.
we don't directly respond to you, and then in the course of our discussion we would respond.
Okay. Well, okay. My name's Emily, 97 Glendale Road. I guess I wanted to express my support to the elimination of preliminary elections, because I agree with a lot of things that you said, that it is not, it limits the candidates that the public can take time to investigate and to view, because the fact of the matter is that most people don't start looking into elections until September. And you know, we could be idealistic about it and say you can take out your papers in April, but realistically, it's not how it works. And I know that one of the issues, I'm really into human rights, and I'm on the Human Rights Commission of this city, and so I was reading the Declaration of Human Rights, looking at what it had to say about elections. And there was this one part that I think really speaks to this issue, and that's, everyone has the right of equal access to public service in their country. And I know that sounds very idealistic, because creating equal access for anything seems impossible. And that doesn't mean, though, we shouldn't strive towards it. And I think in this country, one of the biggest issues is that you can't really have equal access to public service when campaigns are run by money. And there are some people that have a lot more money than others, and some that don't. And it's not faulting, you know, somebody because of their class, it's just the way things are. And waiting for getting and having preliminary elections does not help equal access. It, for somebody that does not have as much money, that part, that elimination of those 6 weeks, though they may seem short, is not helpful and it's not good. And looking into the future, what we need as to, I don't think that changing how elections work is the sole thing to getting people to vote. I think that it's deeper than that, but I think it's a key part of it. There are, when you look at the 2008 election, one of the reasons why so many people came out was because they saw a candidate, and you know, then candidate Barack Obama, they thought was different and not the status quo. And it something with preliminary elections, you have the status quo that they have the advantage over things. And when you want, what people really want is options. To go in there and to be able to see, you know, four candidates up there. That was one of the things I loved about the at-large race this time, because there were four candidates. They all had a lot in common, but you know, had it been a preliminary election, had they been running for mayor, all four of them, and there had been a preliminary election, I have no doubt in my mind that it would have been Bill Dwight and Jesse Adams that were the two that would have been accepted right away, because both of them had more name power in this city. And although they may have been the ones that were elected in the end, I think that hearing from four candidates and having everybody share their support for those four candidates was beneficial. So I, again, support preliminary elections. Runoff does not seem feasible, that at least increasing the threshold of the amount of candidates that would run before you have a preliminary, whatever that technical thing is, would be important. The other thing, just quickly, I'd like to say is that there is the, what is it, the free petition? Yeah, that I also believe in wholeheartedly. I think that it can be really hard for certain minority populations. They might not feel like they are represented by their city council, and that they're, you know, for instance, if you are Latino, and you feel like your city councilor is racist, not calling any of your city councilors racist at the moment, because I don't think they are, but it could arise, and they still want to bring something up to the city council, have it as a floor discussion, and they could get those signatures to do it, or even if it's something that, you know, could be a a city councilor would think is not good politically to put their name on, to bring it up as a discussion, that maybe they would vote on, but as a sponsor or as, you know, the person that comes out at it doesn't seem like a good idea. And the free petition would fix that. So, thank you. Yes.
Thank you. Change my mind. But I want to also just say, I want to make sure I clearly heard what you said.
Mm-hmm.
You want to eliminate preliminary elections.
Yes.
The second time you said it, you were in favor.
Oh, my bad. I want to eliminate.
I just wanted to make sure that I understood correctly that you were advocating for eliminating preliminary elections.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Yep.
Mary Ann, do you have anything you want to share?
No.
Closing the public comment then. Back to the full meeting. And again, my apologies for the technical flip. Okay, we have on the table elections, preliminary runoffs, IRVs, and we have not taken any positions on any of that. And Mark, I particularly held off on the signature requirements because I knew this was a hot topic for you and I wanted you to be in the room for this part of the conversation. So do you want to share anything besides how wonderful the weather was in Washington?
Warm topic than we really passed.
Okay.
I don't really feel all that strongly. You know, there was one comment that we did hear, so I thought it was interesting. Bill Dwight had mentioned that, you know, look, there's not a lot of people running for a lot of decisions anyway, and that there maybe shouldn't be all that much concern about making it too easy for somebody to get on the ballot, which would suggest, okay, a low number of signatures. On the other hand, when you look at sort of what seems to be the standard for other cities and towns in Massachusetts that call for more signatures, especially if you're running for citywide positions, but that would suggest, you know, it might be appropriate to go and do 100 signatures for the mayor in the at-large positions. I like the idea of having a certain, you know, a stipulation, a total number of signatures you can get from any one ward when you're running for a citywide position. So I don't know, could you circulate those comments that I put in? And in that I had suggested that maybe 25, a maximum of 25 signatures for anyone, any individual ward would be able to establish that yes, this is a candidate who is serious, has gone to the trouble at least of trying to attract, trying to get his or her name known to more voters outside that particular ward, local residents.
I just want to hold off on that signature. I just want to now go back and focus on the elections themselves.
Oh, well.
Is there anything on the preliminaries or runoffs or IRV that you would like to put forward at this time? We don't have an active proposal on the floor, I do not believe, and we need to reach consensus or take a vote in this area of discussion.
Well, I agree with the idea of tabling the IRV. I think that's fine. But certainly there is a relationship between the IRV and the notion of preliminary elections. If you are going to table that, then I think you have to, maybe appropriate just to leave the status quo for the preliminary elections until the this new board or whatever is looking at IRV, says that if you go with IRV, you're going to get rid of the preliminaries. So in a way, just, you know, defer that one too.
Right, and the other discussion that was brought up was to move to the runoff concept.
Oh, instead of the preliminaries?
Instead of the preliminaries, that we'd have a general election and then X number of days later, which is why Maddie did the homework with Wendy, that we would hold the November election and then would hold it 45 days now, right, Wendy? 45 days after the November election to hold it to have the runoff if someone didn't achieve the 51%.
So I don't have any strong opinion on that. I'm not really sure I see how it's all about different from preliminary still.
The main difference is that current law, if there are more than three candidates, you have to have the preliminary election, even
more than double the number of open spots.
Yes, right. If it's more than double. Even though one candidate may, even though you still, the winner in the, still could get the 50% plus one needed in the general election. So having a runoff would arguably limit the need to have that extra election. There could be a case when you would need a runoff, but there would be instances when you wouldn't need a runoff. You could still have a broad open general election and not have to have that second.
But that means that where no candidate did meet the 50%, then you would be having a a more determinative election sometime in the middle of December?
According to Wendy's timetable.
Yeah. Well, I gotta get over it by November.
And can I just ask the question? Can you have, and I hear Emily's point, but can you have the election, the general election in September, and then if need be have the runoff in November? Just to be crazy. No. Okay. No, just
election is always November.
Always November. Okay. I just wanted to make sure that.
By law? Is it by law?
Okay. I just wanted to make sure we weren't missing that as the option as well. Maddie, you wanted to move in this area?
Well, I just want to say that I want to eliminate the preliminary election for the reasons that I said yesterday, because I feel like it gives the incumbent an advantage, and I feel like it gives a disadvantage to lesser-known candidates with less money, because they have a shorter time to make their case and they have a steeper hill to run. With that in mind, I feel comfortable with multiple candidates going into the general election, and people being able to choose whomever they want. And I am not wedded to this concept of plurality, of getting a 51%. I'm not persuaded by that. I did a little reading about it today, and I feel like it's a very old-fashioned idea. And although you can end up with a weak governor or a weak mayor, then that person has to build coalitions, and they have to work with other branches of government. And this is what they do in Europe, where they literally have the Green Party has somebody, the Nazi Party has somebody. I mean, it's extreme. But somehow they have these coalitions. So I just think that I think that the concept of having a majority, of being wedded to a majority winner is, it's naive, like I said, in terms of feeling as though it's representative, because so few people vote. And I mean, I know, like in countries where, you know, they have elections and they're not real elections, and then they say, you know, our glorious leader got 98% of the vote. You know, it's like, that just doesn't carry the day, that 50%. And I think if you end up, like I said, with a weak mayor, well, that person's gonna have to play ball.
Other people like to cover this, Eric, yeah?
This is a question. So your sense of the 51% being old-fashioned and the plurality being fine, does that hold if there are 17 people in the field as opposed to 3 or 4, so that the vote is very chopped up?
Right, I hear you.
The reason I raise this is because it's, again, I'm concerned that we not do something here, mm-hmm, that is entirely the product of our view of the current state of things. Mm-hmm. Because I'm hopeful that someday it won't be hard to get candidates to run. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm hopeful that things will change and shift in our society in ways that will allow people to feel that they have the time and the energy, mm-hmm, to do that. So I just don't want to.
Well, I guess I'm thinking about the reading that I did and stuff, just even, you know, like Ralph Nader, and there's a woman at Mount Holyoke College that does all this research into that. It's all about, like, it's not so much focused from the voter turnout. The focus is about candidate turnout and dragging, you know, like increasing voter turnout by increasing candidate turnout, sort of. So what I think about is that we have had a traditional two-party system, which I understand in Northampton, that when we have a preliminary, it's not between, you know, a Republican and a Democrat, but I've worked on campaigns and people get money from PACs that are related to these major parties. So, third party, what I would like to do is lay the groundwork for the ability for serious third party candidates to enter in the mix, and I don't think, you know, in one cycle or in 5 years, but over time for them to be able to really become a player at the table and eventually, you know, gain the groundswell to be a viable part of our system.
Mark?
Just in regard to Gamble's point then too, but you know, she's right actually. We are still looking at this in terms of three candidates or four, but you know, theoretically it is possible you could have 17. What about then the idea of
San Francisco had that?
Yeah. Right, but what about then, which would be, I think, difficult to have 70 people all attending a debate. I don't know if you have enough lines on the ballot for 17 people. But what about then the option of raising the threshold from more than 2-1 to 3-1? Mm-hmm. So that would decrease the number of preliminaries you have now. You would still have more, you still wouldn't get 17 people showing up in the final ballot, but you know, you'd now get 3-1 instead of 2-1.
I don't understand.
Right now, you have to hold a preliminary. If more than double the number of open spaces, you have candidates that have more than double the number of open spaces. Well, what if you had 3 times the number of open spaces? Mm-hmm. That way you've had 6 people able to run for the 2 at-large positions. You would still be culling the field a little bit, but on fewer occasions, because you would now allow more people to move into the front line.
The problem with that would be if 7 people came out, who's going to say who's out?
No, that's a preliminary then.
Then you are with a preliminary then. Okay.
A preliminary, so
I thought you were saying basing that without the preliminary.
But with fewer preliminaries, because you would need, there'd be fewer occasions they'd have that many candidates.
What I like about that is that it does, you know, it hits the saving money piece. There'd be fewer preliminaries, which I think our clerk said she's in favor of eliminating the preliminary because it's expensive and time-consuming for her office. And then, I mean, I would actually credit Emily with that idea. She's the one who said raising the threshold on the preliminary.
Mm-hmm. Mark? Bill?
Even in that scenario, you still have the possibility of a plurality winner. Mm-hmm. I am not sanguine about that possibility. In addition to the main example you gave yesterday, you look at England right now, they call first past the post. If you top vote get it, regardless of percentage, you get the first shot building the coalition. So Cameron, the Tory, got a very small plurality. The vast majority of Britain voted for either Labour or Liberal Democrats. So essentially the left of center parties got the vast majority, but Labour and LDP hate each other. So LDP coalitions with the Tories, but they're not compromising. They implemented a giant right-wing austerity plan, which is fully antithetical to the LDP, and the countries are suffering economically for it. So I don't see that as a great example of plurality winning. So if that was the situation, I would be down as a block. I would urge the council to strip it out, and if it was in there at the end, I would campaign against supporting the charter at the referendum, and that being the event.
Could you clarify what specifically are you opposed to?
Any circumstance where someone can become mayor or city councilor or school committee without having 50% plus one of the vote at the end of the day. I'm being late. So.
Mark?
I don't understand that all the issue about the coalitions. I mean, we don't have partisan politics here. We don't really have slates, you know. The person who gets 31% or 34% in a three-person race, whatever it is still going to be mayor. But that person may not feel like, oh, I got a huge, you know, groundswell this morning, but I'm still the mayor. I still have a mandate to run as mayor. Is there, is it really compromising just the effectiveness of the office?
Todd,
last night, David raised the case of Maine, where you had two left-wing candidates and one right-wing candidate, and the right-wing candidate won. And is that what is of concern to you, Bill, that sort of scenario could take place?
I mean, it's actually because it's one I don't like. I mean, okay. The person that won is not reflective of the popular will, and is not being constrained by that fact at all.
But Bill, when you have 48% of people showing up to vote for a new mayor the first time in 12 years, I mean, how can you say that the will of the people, I think that's...
But then that 48%, Maddie, just to respond, that 48% then would be of one-third. So only 17%, wait, just hear me out. If three people run, one person wins with 35%, and 48% showed up, 17% of the people elected the next mayor. 17% elected the next mayor.
But what I'm saying is that over time, if there's more candidates, you know, the candidates are going to bring out the voters. That's what I'm saying. Because right now, in many elections, there's no candidate that reflects certain viewpoints. I mean, like I said, even myself, in many elections, people aren't liberal enough for me.
Is there any place where we know already that more candidates bring out more voters? Because when I hear you say it, it sounds really good, but it sounds like it's still a theory. It sounds like trickle down, you know, which sounded like a really good theory and had no basis in fact. So
well, don't you think, though, Gail? I mean, when Barack Obama ran, and that was like the first time that there was this super viable African American candidate, I mean, then the African American voter registration just swelled and the people came to the polls. I mean, when people have a candidate suddenly that reflects them or reflects their viewpoint, I do think that they follow. But I don't think that we can expect that, you know, if all of a sudden we had a Peace and Freedom Party in Northampton, that, you know, they would suddenly be, like, really well, like, you know, supported by a committee full of heavy hitters in Northampton. I mean, it takes time.
By my recollection, we have spent now about an hour and 15 minutes between the two nights on this so far. I repositioned my comment from yesterday, which was to send all of this to keep status quo and send all of it to a study commission, because we could try to take a vote now, but if we were to eliminate the preliminary now, just as a possibility, theoretically 2 or 3 or 4 years down the road, if the study commission were to come back and recommend IRV, we would be having another change in the way elections are tallied. There would be three different ways within this decade. So I'd rather, if we're going to take it, bite the bullet, make a decision now, or wait for the study commission to take a look at all the options, what's legal in the state, what new machines would be needed, how much it's going to cost us, how it would implement, would it do the research behind it that I think you pointed out yesterday. This is areas we hadn't even gotten into. And give that to somebody else to have the energy, have people sit on it to see if we can come out with the best proposal as opposed to a proposal tonight and then maybe a proposal in 2 years. So I'm just going to put that out there as something for people to focus on as opposed to starting to rehash some of the arguments that we did last night.
Can I just ask for one point of clarification?
Sure.
Before we talk? So the options are to stay with the current system, which is a prelim election. We could tweak the prelim election. We could shift to a runoff, which would mean a runoff vote, if needed, would take place 42 days after the general election, which would be at the extreme December 15th. Would mean an election around December 10th to the 15th. Or to just table it completely. Those are the...
Well, it's not tabling completely. It's sending it to commission.
Okay.
Sending it to commission. The committee had strong opinions on this and heard a lot of opinions on this and felt that more time than the 90 days we were allowed to do our business is necessary to come to a solution that will be widely accepted by the group. We've heard two members who are sitting next to each other. One who said, you know, it's a hot button issue for me on this side, and another one who said, I'd even go as far as campaigning against it if it was included. So I'm just trying to find a middle ground here that we can walk away with and feel comfortable.
I would just add that I think technology is going to change elections in the future. We don't know what it's going to look like, but I would think studying this intensely, looking at other examples of IRV as it's played out, someone sent us copies about the problems they had in San Francisco. I think it's going to be the future. It's going to, I think, allow for a lot of flexibility, and I would suggest punting on this.
Okay. I don't want to use the word punting. Okay. I would like to that we strongly recommend that a elections commission be established to look at, that would be comprised of the city clerk, would be in it and or chairing it, but we would need to make sure that this had representatives from the community, such as ourselves, 9 members, who would then move forward on looking at all of the options that are allowable under law, even consider ones that we might have to have legal changes to if we had to do an IRV, and take our time and really build that coalition necessary so we don't have this be the divisive issue that could sink the charter come November. Are people there, or are we still other places? Mark?
Can I just make, I think actually you're right on that, because you are saying not just what the law allows, but as consistent with what technology supports.
Correct.
In the future. And that makes it kind of appropriate to say, well, when that technology exists, you know, what should be, another commission could do that. But, you know, I would like to put forward then, in the meantime, the option of raising the threshold from the current 2-to-1, calling for preliminary to 3.
That would allow the plurality winners.
And then right.
I mean, you're talking about, that's still an issue of instant runoff voting. I mean, if LePage in Maine, you know, ended up with just being, would not have been preferred by people who had a second choice, that still is only something that would have been established.
But I understand, but all I'm saying is, are we going to tinker, or are we going to say to the whole group, you know, there's a lot of divisions here. I don't think there's a majority on any of this. Actually, I think there's at least 3 different camps here. How do we get to conclusion within this group, and how do we advance that? And my recommendation, again, is to say, status quo, send the rest to commission, and we can write all of our opinions and our concepts on that. We can even join and ask to be on that commission for those that are passionate about this. But I just feel that if we do a little bit of tinkering now, then there's going to be the, well, we already took care of it, we don't need to go there. We already addressed this, we don't need to go there. Let's put all those eggs in that basket, give it to the city council and say, this is your area.
I think that you're talking, I mean, the issue of the instrument of voting is something for the future. Mm-hmm. I think that's appropriate given questions of where the technology is going to be. But, you know, this is still an opportunity to tinker. And if this idea of just raising the threshold is not something that is so heated as to, you know,
it is
inspire.
That's not a tinker, it's a big change.
And
you feel that's a big change?
If someone can win an election without a majority, I mean, you can make the argument for it, but it's not a tinker. That's a big change in an election process.
It might not be for you, but at least for him and for me, that's a big change. And I would have problems equally on the level of Bill is having.
Well, that's where it's going to be.
Okay, awesome. No, I was just going to say, what about the runoff, or is a mid-December runoff, if it's needed, out of, you know, beyond the pale?
Again, if we're going to make a recommendation, I think we bite the bullet and say, okay, we're going to, you know, get rid of preliminaries, we're going to recommend runoffs, we're going to go down that path, put that on the table. Or we're going to take everything, including IRV, runoffs, whether we should have preliminaries, majority of preliminaries or minorities, and give it to the next group and let them decide. I think a tinker now and then a tinker, or a major change 2 years from now, or a major change now and a major change 2 years from now, however you describe it, is more than the public is going to feel comfortable.
It mostly is establishing that a committee doesn't feel comfortable with it. If we're at an impasse, what choice is there?
Gail and then Tom?
Normally, I would feel really bad about putting this big an issue, about not dealing with this big an issue in a group like ours that's asked to make recommendations about the charter. But on this one, I feel like I'm strongly in support of David's idea. And the reason is, there, I have 2 reasons. One is that we're talking about very complicated decisions and outcomes, a lot that we don't know answers to. And the second reason is that what we're talking about is multiple positive values bumping up against each other. We're not, these are, nobody's doing Nobody's saying negative or bad things here. It's important to think about Maddie's issues of access to the ballot by candidates. It's important to think about Bill's issues of what it means once you have an election to try to govern under circumstances that aren't a majority. It's important to think about those and to think about them very fully. So I support your idea.
Tom?
I have a question as to procedure. If we kick it down the road to the city council, does that, if somebody could explain, what does that mean? We have a charter that presumably is going to be acted upon next November. Is this committee slash that's going to look at this, is it going to propose something to be included in this particular charter, or will it be a charter amendment after this charter is presented?
My gut would be that this would be after this initiative, that we would take the time to do the research that Wendy's talked about, look at the new machines, because I think that's critical, because I think your points are correct. Technology will take care of a lot of this, and we can go to IRB. And if we can go to IRB in 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 years, then that solves a lot of these issues. But I would suggest that this is not on the November charter track. This is on a special act in itself.
Okay. That helps me decide my position on this.
And which is?
Open field in the runoff if nobody receives a majority.
I'm confused. Help me out.
Open election, no preliminary. Preliminary and go to a runoff.
As opposed to the study committee?
No, it can have a study committee too. It's
okay.
Going to be if it's going to be a subsequent charter change. But I think that we stand the possibility of a gridlock in that type of a study that's not going to result in what I think are very, very valid concerns about allowing as many people as possible into the field. And if we have the opportunity to do that, I don't think I'm not afraid to go forward and make that decision. I don't want to shy away from it.
I'm going to second Tom's. I mean, I support his idea of eliminating the prelim, moving to a runoff, and also suggesting the committee look at IRG down the line. I'm going to put my pen forward.
Wendy, technically, can we do a runoff? Are there other cities in the Commonwealth that can do a runoff?
I don't know. I don't have the answer to that. I mean, my question to the runoff is if you're doing a runoff that's considered like another election, do I then have to have another open time frame for voter registration? There's these other questions. I mean, if you're technically doing another election as a runoff, then 20 days before that, are voters going to be allowed to register to vote?
This concept only came up yesterday night, so that's why we're sort of...
And so that's my question, too. I mean, if you're doing a runoff election, is it just for the people that were voting and that were registered at that particular time for that election, or do I open up and have voter registration again 20 days before the instant runoff, before the instant runoff voting or whatever? Yeah. So those are the questions. I don't have answers to
that. You have to update your...
Well, no, people would have a right to come in that aren't registered to register.
Steve?
And have a right to vote.
This is a big issue as well, because as the city clerk says, I mean, Cambridge is the closest thing we have in Massachusetts to that type of voting. I'm not even sure what we're talking about. So if you make a decision to go down this path, it would take an awful lot of research in writing, because there's nothing to base it on in Massachusetts. So we'd have to work with the Secretary of State's office. It would be a huge task. It could be written up by tomorrow.
No one does a runoff in Massachusetts.
So we're at that point of we've got 26 hours to finish. And I'm just watching the clock tick and thinking, okay, can of worms, but we need to come to a conclusion. Red and Megan.
I support what you put forward, period.
Is that a motion?
We might need to get there. Megan?
I support it too. Based on Wendy's questions and our questions, I don't think that this is something that we can do right now. I think that having a study to look at this is really important.
In the previous days, when we've had other issues, have there been...
We've reached consensus. We've reached consensus. We are not...
Four-term mayor got the consensus, huh? For the four-year mayor.
I don't think we're on this issue. I think we're going to have to come down to a vote, unfortunately. But.
Or just accept it. You're not going to get the consensus, and that's important. Then.
Well, take a look at your consensus chart. This is your gradients of agreement, folks.
Do you have one?
Okay.
What is the proposal?
The proposal is to outline that the committee had heard diverse opinions on how elections should be conducted in the city of Northampton. There was concern that we did not have all the information given the timetable. We heard proponents for IRV, for eliminating the preliminary elections, for runoffs, for keeping the status quo. We strongly suggest that the City Council establish an election commission. Are you getting into all this?
Yeah.
I'm on a roll. establish an election commission comprised of X that would investigate and report back to the city within one calendar year or something. We can put a time limit on it. I'm comfortable with that. To make a recommendation if there is any for a special act charter.
Special act amending this charter in the
future.
In Article 7.
Right.
Can I just add one thing that, and that this commission really maybe should wait until after the state establishes its guidelines for the new voting machine.
Correct. I think that the whole piece around technology is all tied to that, because I take that as a friendly amendment. Tom, I saw a hand for you.
Yeah, I guess I'm going back and forth in my mind how strongly I feel about this, have an opportunity to make an important change in the charter. And because of the fact that whatever we present is not going to be the final version that gets offered to the city for a vote, there is time for the City Council to look into this, and if it turns out that it is not possible to do a runoff, or if there are issues with regard to opening up voter registration after the first election at which there was not a majority, there would be an ability to change this. And so I want to throw that out, that whatever we recommend, I think we all recognize, is not the final document. And if we feel that change should come, then perhaps it's an opportunity to send a message that we feel the change should come. If we feel that we're not ready to make the recommendation for change consensus-wise, then that's the consensus of the committee. I'm still willing to go with consensus, but I don't want us to overlook the fact that there still is an opportunity to look into some of these technical issues that are being raised.
Yeah.
To support that idea, I'd like to offer a friendly amendment to your idea, David, which is that when we lay out what we're asking the City Council to do in terms of creating this commission, that we give them our examples of issues so far, that we not just make it blurry and big, but let them see what some of the stuff is that we've been discussing, including some that might be resolved quicker. Like, we could find out if the runoff is a big deal since it's never been in Massachusetts. We could learn that. And if it's something that can be resolved earlier, maybe they want to take it. But in other words, structure it for them so that they can take it from us and act.
So just to clarify, you're structuring it that there's a consensus for change, but we don't have the ability in with our time frame to look at all the issues. But if the council is able to explore these things over the next couple of months and clarify some issues, they might be they would be able to go ahead with some changes.
Right, I don't know that there's a consensus for change. I would say consensus for change if some of the big concerns about
there is concern. I would leave with Maddie's opener, which was there is concern that there are disenfranchised voters within our city limits, and it is something that we would like to try to correct. How we do that is the discussion point. That's, to me, is the compelling part of looking at this is, okay, let's put everything on the table. When you see a problem, you have to be able to put everything on the table. An election should be on the table when you take a look at that. Okay? And why do we have so many disenfranchised voters? Why do we have so many people who aren't even registered? I mean, Wendy, we have another 8,000 people in the city that are eligible to vote that don't vote because they're not even registered. Forget about the registered people coming out. So what is that all about? And again, that whole concept of the study commission, to me, it's like, let's look at all that. Why aren't people voting? What are the handicaps? What are the roadblocks that you talked about, Emily, so articulately in your spiel? That's why I don't want it to rush through and put a band-aid here and put a band-aid there. Let's do a comprehensive and even give them more time than we even had to really look at this issue and figure it out and not try to push through something that is going to have... I can see the November election when you're standing holding a sign saying vote no in the charter, and you're saying, oh yes in the charter. That's not a good message to send out here, and I think that we have to be circumspect as to what we advance.
Let me just clarify, Bill, are you opposed to eliminating the prelims, or are you just opposed to eliminating the 50 plus one?
Just the latter. If we eliminate the prelims with the December runoff, I'm totally fine with that.
Okay, that's my understanding, perhaps I'm wrong, but my understanding is there might be a consensus around eliminating the prelims, but we're not sure what could replace it efficiently and effectively.
And again, as the clock ticks, and I understand your point of view, all right, to me it's do you tinker or do you go for the big structure change? And I just want to go for the big structure change. Because I think this is a legitimate point. Go ahead, Maddie.
I'm sorry, but I hear you say that, but yesterday I thought you were saying you're not for any change at all, that you want the field cleared fast of weirdo candidates.
Several times yesterday I felt that you were not listening or hearing what I was trying to say, which is why I was frustrated with you. Okay? To say that I do not believe or am trying to disenfranchise voters, I found offensive. Okay, that's what I heard, and I found that offensive. All right? What I'm trying to do is empower voters. As a disenfranchised voter bloc that I was, I am very keen about being a minority, fighting my way into the Democratic Party, fighting my way into this city when gay people weren't allowed to run here because we were gay. So I've been down that path. So I'm very concerned about how we empower people to run. That has been my whole career in politics. So anything that you inferred other than that is not appropriate. I am not trying to shut the process down correctly, quickly. I am trying to create a point where, in the end, the most people have endorsed this candidacy, so there is the opportunity. How you get there, I'm open to it. I listened to what Emily had to say. I listened to the IRB. But eventually what I want is somebody who you don't end up with a fragmented government like Maine has. Okay? Maine is the key example for me of what's wrong with that scenario. I want somebody who, if I have a chance between two liberals, and if I choose one, that means the conservatives could get in, to be really candid. I want to be able to say, no, let me choose my first guy, and then we'll end up voting for the liberal against the conservative in the final race. That's fine. I can go there. But I don't want to end up with the conservative ultimately. But that's my personal issues, obviously. Anybody want to pick up on my craziness?
Well, no, but just to clarify for the audience who's going to be hearing this debate, just reverse it for somebody who feels the same way about a conservative candidate.
Right.
You got to do this so that whoever's ox is gored is comfortable with the process.
If there are two conservatives running against each other versus against a liberal, I can go down that path. be equally as. So, where are we?
Accept the status quo and promote the idea of study commission.
I would just pick up on Gail's point and not just sort of promote a study commission, but encourage the types of change that we seem to have a consensus around, which is there's a problem with preliminaries, and it would be nice to find some alternative, be it runoffs, IRBs, whatever the most practical in the short, medium, and long term.
I'd like to add, I don't see a huge problem with the way our elections are done. I don't know that the general election and then having a runoff, it just makes the general election, which does give more time, I suppose, but if time's the issue, let's look at that in a different way. I don't feel a great need for change, personally. I think it's something that we should study with the new machines coming down, the new regulations. Absolutely, it'd be great if you looked at it, but I don't, and from who I've talked to, I don't feel that there is a great push for change, personally. Just to add that to the comments, if you're going to.
Yeah, I'll do a motion. I put a motion on the floor.
Wait for Tom.
Yes. Motion, Tom, I'm going to put on the floor, is there was concern was raised about disenfranchised voters and low voter turnout. We heard proponents speak to IRV, eliminating preliminary elections and runoff, as well as keeping the status quo. No consensus was reached. Thereby, my motion states that we basically say that we are taking this section of discussion, keeping the status quo, and asking the City Council to form a commission that will look to ways to deal with the disenfranchised voters and low voter turnout, and look at the various election options that are allowed by law. Technology, do you want to throw that in there?
Only that. And given that the state will soon be adopting new guidelines for election machines, and Northampton will have to go and adopt, Northampton is anyway going to have to go and get new voting machines, that this commission should be deferred until we know what those guidelines would be and thus what the technical abilities would allow.
Thank you. Is there any second to that motion?
Second.
Any more discussion on this motion?
I understood the motion to say that there were proponents of the status quo. Is anyone on our committee here from being a proponent of the status quo? Is it?
We heard from proponents of the status quo.
From the public?
Correct.
Right, but not from our committee.
This is just pending some further study.
No, that's different. I think I understood that everyone in this room was in favor of improving the election process and some change. And if I misunderstood someone, let me know that. None of us are in favor of the preliminary election.
No. That is not a correct characterization.
Well, is there anyone here that's in favor of the preliminary election?
I would go.
I am.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm also.
I don't like any of the other options.
Right.
I mean.
Okay, I'm sorry, so I did not hear that.
I was being quiet.
Then your motion is accurate.
When I was trying to say there are at least three camps here, that's what I'm trying to juggle in terms of my mind, that there are, it's a floating, and that
and
there are people who are in different places here. We're not. It's not a yes or a no, and that's why I'm trying to find that consensus amendment to go through, or motion. Maddie, please.
Can I add a friendly amendment to that, which is that my concern is not just about voter disenfranchisement. I want articulated language about the scarcity of viable third-party candidates. I want that to be in any compromising language we have about setting forth, framing the problem to
Can you come up with a different term than third party, only because we don't have parties in municipal elections?
Right.
It's a broader range of
just whatever that is, I'm very comfortable with that as a friendly amendment, but broader range of a broader
broader range of ideological diversity, political spectrum.
Yeah.
Are you comfortable with that, Meg?
Totally.
Okay.
And just not to leave out the concern about plurality. Votes and governing.
Right,
that was also the
answer. I don't think you have to put that in there on my account.
No,
if I
no,
want to
no,
you're not alone on that.
Yeah,
I think that
people want the runoff, after the runoff.
I agree that it should be a majority. I mean, I've said that directly.
So again, there's at least three or four different positions.
Chairing
this has been really a lot of fun.
We're just saying trigger the concerns in the motion so the city council sees the range of concerns. That's all. That's
now, I'm going to do two things. Take a vote and then ask for someone who feels comfortable writing this up. All in favor of this motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Does anyone want to go on record as either being opposing or abstaining? And that the motion passed unanimously. Is there anyone who would like to write this up?
We're not allowed to collaborate.
Well, we're
if it's less than a quorum, can't they? Yeah.
Two people can do it. So do I have two people who would like to do this? Gail and Tom.
Somebody can write.
Thank you, Gail and Tom.
Pleasure.
Okay. We've been asked to restate the motion again, so someone want to take a first shot at it? We've been asked to restate the motion by the clerk, so we really have to get this right. Do I start with the preamble or just go straight to the I don't know, is what I want to say as the intro to the piece, is the piece about encouraging and the disenfranchising and encouraging various populations and diversity. That doesn't have to be in the motion. The motion is that we, the hardcore motion, that we review the sections on election laws within the state regarding to preliminary elections, general elections, runoff elections, IRV. We heard from positions people supporting each of those. We suggest that a commission be formed by the City Council to do a complete study of these options. Taking into regard state law,
emerging technology.
Maddie, do you have a thing you want?
I mean, not hanging right on that cloth, I'm sorry.
Okay.
With a goal to?
Thank you.
Expanding participation.
Expanding voter participation.
Candidate and voter participation.
Okay? So that's the technical motion. So we're going to put, you want to read it back to us, Mayor?
This committee reviewed all the election options within.
It reviewed all the election options, including eliminating preliminary election.
General runoff, IRB being listened to other positions. And
we recommend.
Recommend the commission by the city council do a complete study of the options in regards to state law and emerging technology with the goal to expand voter participation.
We're comfortable.
And given that we expect that the state will soon establish guidelines for the new voting machine technology, we further recommend that the committee, that the council defer this establishment of the commission, this study committee, until those guidelines, until the state announces those guidelines.
I would say not defer it, but take those guidelines into consideration,
right.
And that that requires the this study committee. And you use the word commission, maybe it should be committee, but they direct that the committee take.
As continuing commissions, I thought it was a big deal.
Okay.
I thought it's a big deal. I just want to up it above this normal committee and just
got
say
it.
This is a commission. This is a big
okay.
deal.
But that I don't think that I wouldn't suggest that they defer the establishment and the study until after the state sets forth its guidelines. I think that we just say that the commission should take into consideration the state's guidelines, which are expected in the near future.
I think if you do it now, this committee is going to end up with the same questions that we're having. If this committee waits until after the state comes up with the new guidelines, which should be very soon, given that the state is not in compliance
right.
with federal election laws.
But I think as you take into consideration the new technology guidelines that will be established by the state.
They can start their work.
Yeah.
And
they can go through the whole, is IRB, what's the status of runoff, what do you have to do, what laws have to be changed if you want to put a runoff in, what's your time, they can do all that homework.
I don't want them to spin their wheels for a year and end up coming up with something that is instantly negated or precluded by whatever the new guidelines suggest for the new voting machines.
Okay. All right. I don't think we're that different on this issue, so I want to move forward.
But I'm willing to move forward with
yes.
Mark's position.
Yeah.
I questioned, my concern is that it just never gets done.
Yeah. And I want them to have an out.
Well, don't have them get an in, but after you get out, then they can.
Do you have this? Do you want to try it one more time? We'll take one more final vote on this.
This committee reviewed the election options, including preliminary, general, runoff, IRB, looked at other positions, recommends that the city council establish a commission, complete study of options with regard to state laws, emerging technology, with the goal to expand voter participation, taking those state guidelines into consideration.
Voter and candidate.
Voter and candidate participation. Are we there? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Does anyone want to go on record as being opposed or abstaining to this? The motion carries. In the interim, the last that particular area was signature requirements. Mark, you did a lot of work and research in this area. Do you want to begin the conversation?
Okay. I noted a couple of comments earlier this evening. My recommendation though was that given that 50 times a week is very simple to get, and that there is now sort of a standard or precedent in other cities and towns about a size in Massachusetts for higher threshold for signatures, that we recommend 100, what did I recommend? 100 signatures for city councilors and school committee, 150 for mayor, and that the at-large positions and the mayor have no more than 25 signatures coming from any individual ward. This would promote the idea.
No more than
25. So that if somebody's running, if I'm from Ward 7, I can't get, you know, all 150 just from my ward. If you're running for at-large, a citywide position, you do something in the signature to establish that you are making some inroads for citywide. I would also like, and this one isn't necessarily part of the charter, but if the charter says that the signature form has to be something adopted, whatever is put forth by the city clerk, that signature form does not have the current requirement that this testimonial to good character, which is really kind of meaningless, that is currently on the signature sheet for Northampton candidates.
Are you arguing, or are you?
No, can I?
Can I just ask Steve a background question? What is the purpose of signature requirements? What is considered best practice in the state? Why did you come up with the numbers that you came up with in your draft?
I think the signature requirements are just to like test and see if a person's, you know, serious about this. And having signatures for at-large candidates at a minimum amount from each board would show that candidates should have citywide appeal. The numbers I came up with actually, you know, they were just placeholders. I didn't really think about this for Northampton, this was for someplace else. It was actually someplace else, it was a similar population. And you know, the numbers that Mark came up with, just my gut, I think it's going to come to public.
What did you say?
It's still kind of low. I mean, I stumbled upon a statute today when I was looking through a bunch of things on this, and there is a statute on signature requirements, but it's not applicable to Northampton. But it was, for mayor, it was 300. For anybody running at large, 200. For anybody at ward, 100.
Well, this is, I mean, the example that I gave during one of our public presentations, and I used Northampton, West Springfield, and Gloucester. Gloucester is a 300 for mayor. You know, one of the comments that we got, though, from one of the president of the council, Bill Blake, was, look, you know, it's not as if we're really, you know, we should really worry about making this too easy. Anyway, because we're not getting all that many candidates. And well, that's a valid point. Again, I don't think you should look at what's, you know, currently the issue. The guy, I mean, you know, you hope will have a long-term, will be an effect, you know, 100 years or so. But I don't want to, the flip side of that is, are you, for those serious candidates, they're going to do this anyway. I mean, you know, why not say, okay, do 25 hours of community service, or, you know. And so it's like, okay, there you got something really useful out of it, instead of just like gathering signatures. So, you know.
So you were at 150 for mayor?
Yeah, it's about 150 for mayor. And that the others are 100 for the city council and for school committee, which is double.
How much for what?
Same thing, 100. The only 100 difference. For everybody. Sorry?
100 for everybody, even what?
I mean, the big difference is, I mean, there was, you know, Gene Case, one of the others, look, I got 50 signatures in like 2 hours or something. You know.
So just go over them again for me. It's 100 for ward.
That was my recommendation. 100 for city council and for school committee.
Yeah.
150 for mayor. And anybody running in a citywide position, so the at-large counselors, the at-large school committee members, and the mayor,
and the city clerk,
would be limited to no more than 25 signatures from any one board. That's currently not part of
like a distribution.
The Northampton requirement, but it seems to be different among other cities.
So then the most that they'd be able to get would be 175 signatures.
Sorry?
The most that they would be able to get would be 175 signatures.
Well, you're right, 25 times 7. No, you're right. That's an interesting point.
But you know, typically, you tend to submit more signatures than you need in case you got mistakes.
Right. Sure. Because
so you force people to have a cap on the signatures.
At least 25. Right?
You have to put a minimum.
Yeah. I don't think it's a minimum. Yeah. I think it's the at least that you need to go with.
You lose. lose if something.
Because the other thing is that signatures have always been a.
You're saying at least 25 from every ward.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Because you collect more than that, because then when they check out, they might not work out properly. Do you know what I mean? The person's not.
And you also use it as an election tool, that when you're going out and you're knocking on doors. As a candidate, I knocked on doors and I said, "Hi, I'm running for this office. Here's why I'm running. Da 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 da. Would you like to sign my papers?" So it's a tool
to initial organizing.
Pardon?
An initial organizing tool.
And would a ward councilor say, "Well, why do I have to get 100? Because I'm running in a small place. Why does the councilor of Lodge only have to get 100? The councilor of Lodge should get 150.
Well, the councilor of Lodge though has to get signatures from all over the city, and that's where it becomes more onerous.
Todd.
Your question, if we raise this limit, does this put an extra burden on the clerk's office to verify?
Yes.
Yes.
And how onerous is that?
Not very, because on the election papers, you actually put it, you organize it by ward and precinct. You have to put your ward and precinct on there.
So someone literally has to go through and hand check?
Correct. Well, would they computerize it, check it out? They have a scanner that does it, but yes. Okay.
So it's
a step.
If we were to double or triple the limit, it's not going to...
Correct. And they stop at a certain amount. They always overcount what they need, and then they just stop counting. So if you put 500 signatures in, I don't know what the number is, but they would cut it off at like 150 and just say, "Yep, you have more than enough." They don't even worry about it after that. But it is public record if anybody wants to go and play with it, because there were falsified signatures in a local town around here too that ended up coming into play. Other people want to comment on this area?
Still not getting the math, because even if you do no less than 25 from each ward, that's still 175,
right?
Which is more than either.
Your minimum of 150.
Numbers.
Yeah. So I'm going to go back to the maximum 20. If you did put it as maximum 25, I mean, all right, look, it would be obligation of the candidate to make sure I have at least 25, so that I.
But as a candidate, I don't know if that signature is valid or not.
Yeah.
So I would submit 25 signatures from a ward, but end up having one or two kicked off, which frequently is the case.
Right, of course.
And then I'm not eligible in that ward because I didn't. You capped me at 25 and said I had to hit 25.
Can you do a percentage, like at least 10% for every ward?
That's not bad. Yeah.
Or you could do it. You could lower them.
At least
15.
At least 15.
And that'll get you 100. That'll get you 105.
And then you still have to.
You still have to collect.
Come up to 45 more.
45 more.
And do you want? One of the things that I could hear is being said, and you folks out in the rural where it's like 6 and 7. I don't know people downtown. How am I going to collect signatures downtown? That's, you know, just Leeds is a whole other separate community. Florence is a separate community. Are we, by saying that you have to get people from Ward 2?
You're running for at large. You have to get to know people all over the city. It's a part of the obligation.
I'm just playing devil's advocate here.
When you were just, if you were just running from Ward 7, you don't have to get signatures from the other wards.
Well, the flip is true, that if basically if you win four wards in this community, you win the election. You know, so it's, I was just trying to play flip on that bill.
But just to flesh that out, if there's a problem with people running who are not really serious about running, doing it on a lark, mm-hmm. and forcing a costly preliminary election where it really wouldn't be necessary, putting an extra barrier to entry, you got to hit every ward, buddy. Sure, you got some basic level of support before you get in, then having a ward requirement makes sense. If the problem is we want to attract more people running who aren't necessarily wired in, adding a barrier to entry is exacerbating that problem. So the question is, to put a fine point out, do you want less Roy, or do you want more other people?
But this is really not onerous. This is 50
signatures.
Yeah.
The, yeah, I hear you.
You're right, it's not, but it may be to somebody. I'm not strong in this, but I'm uncomfortable with the minimum requirement from each ward. I don't have a problem with 150, but that just, and it's not a strong feeling, it's just my reaction to
it.
About
discussion. Is 15 onerous?
It may be.
But
then you're not really a serious candidate.
Yeah, well, you might be.
Well, then go to the trouble of getting the signatures. Go to
well,
the
what, if you, what if you go to a particular ward and because of your ethnic background, you're not accepted?
Oh, come on.
What do you mean,
come on? Are there really wards like that that's going to go in?
Are there people like that? Yes. I mean, there certainly
so,
are.
I think you turn around and say, look, there's a local issue here that's very hot in Ward 6. And I'm running for everybody else, and I can't. Well, what about that, then? What if there were a local? There were a local issue. I mean, say with regard to the dump. Say everybody in Ward 6 wanted to close the dump. And not one person in Ward 6 is going to do it. And you were a candidate says, we're going to reopen the dump. And you could not get 15 signatures from Ward 6.
Well, there you go. You're done. You don't run.
But that's,
but
that seems that that's undermining.
Ward 6.
But right. And you're undermining the broader community will. But now you can't run because you couldn't get 15 signatures from Ward 6.
Let me just drop it off in a different place. I'm uncomfortable actually raising the limit to 100 in a ward race, especially for school committee. I'm very comfortable in ward just leaving it at 50. I was concerned about the at-large races that should have a higher threshold for signature. But then that was going to be tied to longer terms, but we're not doing that. So I'm just a little uncomfortable with, in a ward, the need to collect more than 50 signatures. I mean, my friend Roy, who said hi to everybody who came over today, he was going to show up at the meeting too, and I said, oh, that's okay. He has no problems collecting his 50 signatures because he goes through Salvo House and he gets his signatures.
Yeah.
And that's how he gets on the mayoral ballot. But I think he has a right to collect those signatures at Salvo House and get on the Ward 3 ballot for a school committee or city council. And he would only need 50 to do that.
You could keep the ward. You could keep the ward signature requirement just for mayor.
Say that again.
You know, keep the ward signature requirement just for the office of mayor.
Just for the.
But we don't have one now.
For out large.
You don't have one now.
We don't have one now.
No.
But you still have theoretical potential of the dump example or something where there's.
Well, if you're running for mayor, you can get 15 signatures from the ward.
Is it theoretically possible? Hopefully you're right, and maybe practically this would never come up. But is there some way to structure this where if you were able to get a minimum number of signatures from 5 out of 7 boards, you would still qualify, that we don't really need all boards? Part of this is what I was saying, is there a way to structure where a maximum, so not all of your signatures come from any one board if you're running for that large position.
Okay, let's deal with the two subjects separately. Let's start with how many signatures do we think for at ward, school committee,
okay,
city council, and then we'll bounce into how we should play that out, because I think that we get one of these off the table. How are we with ward races, and is there a difference between school committee and city council for collecting signatures? Anybody want to weigh in on that?
I don't think there's any difference. This is a first step just for being able to get, just for being able to run. And I agree with Bill that we should do everything we can to encourage that and some minimum standard for taking a look at seriousness. So I would say school committee, city council, ward seats should stay at 50.
I would say that's an entry point for people. Yeah. You know.
I just suggest that if you look at where Northampton stands in regard to the number of signatures and comparable cities and towns in Massachusetts, we're at the very low end.
But again, we're encouraging, here's where we agree, we want to encourage candidates.
Right,
and to encourage candidates who might not have a large following, setting that threshold at 54 ward race and saying, here's where you start. Get out there, you campaign, you get in a debate, the war
board association, you know, it gives you camera time, you talk about the issues, you increase your visibility, people start taking you seriously, you might actually win the election. But if we all of a sudden make them have 100 or something, that might be just a higher threshold than they can meet to start the ballot. So it would be,
but you know, the suggestions we got from the other candidates, people who spoke to the meeting, was, you know, it ain't that tough.
Understand you're coming from Mark, and but I think the optics, if we were to make a change, some people are going to lock into this and perceive it as being restrictive, mm-hmm. and not really take the time to understand the logic. And I don't think we've got a problem. So I'm not sure why we need to fix. That's my perception. If there was a problem associated with 50 signatures, then I would be open to a change, but I don't really perceive a problem. Is there one that I'm not aware of?
Well, the only thing is, look, you don't want to discourage people who are going to be serious candidates, but you don't want to make it a bother for the city in terms of the expense, perhaps for the preliminary, you know, for the other candidates to be in a debate with somebody who's not city, who really is not going to mount a real campaign.
But is that
just putting forward a name so they can get his or her name on the ballot?
Is that a big problem in the city right now?
I know a guy who ran for a school committee a couple of years ago here in Northampton, and he did not mount the campaign. He's actually talking about it. I was his campaign manager. He didn't ask me to be a treasurer. Okay, sure, I'll be a treasurer. And he wasn't serious about it, you know. And he didn't actually campaign. Had there been one more candidate, they would have had to go to a preliminary.
I thought I'd make a distinction between people becoming a viable candidate and then people becoming a viable candidate to win. Like, I don't think that we should have a standard. To me, that's putting the cart before the horse. You shouldn't have to prove that you can win to run. So the idea that you'd have to be popular and known in all the wards, you're gonna have to have that to win, that's true. But I don't think you have to have that to run. And I do think that people, even who have no chance of winning, who might be having one issue like close the dump, they'll bring that into the debate and, you know, everybody's better for it. So. I just think you put the cart before the horse to say, you got to show that you can win before you can run.
But this is, I mean, what you're still talking about is, where is the point where you want to go and discourage the non-serious candidate? You know, I wonder if the whole point is, get rid of signatures, make them, okay, you have to do 2 hours of picking up garbage downtown. You know, I mean, it's something that's, because that's all the signature requirement is.
Okay, I'm conscious of just time and what we would like to accomplish.
Okay.
Let's just take a quick idea and even float the concept of a compromise of 75 for a ward or city council. It's upping it a little bit from where it currently is. I still comfortable with 50, but I just want to know if there's a way we
can. Right. 54th,
you want to go 54th? Okay. Let's just take a 50, take a look at your consensus sheet and see where you are in 50 for city council and ward council. I'm getting so tired. You know where I'm at.
City council and school committee,
which is correct.
Yeah. And ward.
Just ward.
I support that.
50.
Yeah. I like that.
I stand aside.
Support.
Support.
I like it.
We're there. 50. Okay, done. 50 for both the city council ward and school committee ward. Now we're going to talk about at large. Oh, there's trouble.
Good thing you weren't here before.
15 minutes, I'm waiting for Chinese food.
Did you get enough for all of us?
At large. Yeah. At large.
We'll throw out numbers.
Would they change? Yes, let's throw out numbers. And would it be difference between, we have four, and oh God, we have a whole mess of races here, folks. You've got Forbes Library, you've got. They run at large.
Do they need signatures?
Do they need signatures?
Yes, they need signatures to go on the ballot. The Oliver will
trustee signature, that runs at large. All the other at-large races, are we differentiating between some of them?
I'd say differentiate. Can we propose keeping the status quo on Forbes? And I mean, is there an issue with these small?
You're trouble fighting people in that. Gene, yeah. Help me out. What are the other races? Forbes?
Smith, Oliver Forbes. Smith, of course, is the trustees.
Smith Rogue.
That's pretty much.
Yeah.
It's pretty much it.
Two Forbes elections. It's like Forbes Library and the trustees of Forbes something.
Yeah.
And there's Oliver Smith. Smith Agriculture, and there's one more. I was looking at the
Oliver Will Trust.
It's like, there could be like five of them actually.
I agree with Todd. Keep those the same and consider school committee at large and counselor at large.
And how about Smith
Rogue? CPA.
The CPA is another one, right?
CPA.
What are they right now?
50.
They're
50? Okay, help me out here. Todd, throw a proposal.
I propose keeping them at 50. Those smaller ones, we're not talking about counselor at large and mayor yet.
Or
school committee.
And how about Smith Folk?
50. Keep that at 50.
Are we all in consensus that Smith Folk stays at 50 for an at-large citywide race?
Yes.
Okay. And the others as well, the other down ballot races. That's a politically correct term. So we're looking at four races now, because I'm going to throw a clerk in there. We didn't deal with clerk. Clerk, mayor, school committee at large, city council at large. Give a number. Pick a number out of that.
I thought the number was 150 for mayor, 100 for at-large races, and 50 for the boards, sort of the small boards, and the school committee. That's what I thought.
That's what I heard too. Those numbers work for me. 150 for mayor. Not talking about
various boards.
And 100 for the at-large school committee and at-large council.
Clerk.
And city clerk.
Yes.
All right.
Within to the ward limitations.
We'll get to that in a headache later. Okay, so 150 for the mayor's race, 100 for city clerk and school committee at large and city council at large. We there? Are we in consensus?
What are they now?
50.
50. All 50.
Everything's 50.
And no ward requirements for
right.
at large.
Okay, we're all comfortable with that? Consensus? Okay, we move on to then, do any of those four races, I assume we're not going to talk about the down ballot races because that would be even crazier. But of those four top races, should any of them have specific ward requirements to balance them out? They all can't come from one ward.
I like the idea of having a ward requirement, but I'm cognizant of Mark's concern, but if it could be sort of a limit that would allow a candidate to just collect from five or six in case there's an issue with one particular ward. I'm not wed to it.
Oh, I know how you can say it. So, you know, with a minimum of 25 signatures from at least four wards.
No more than 50% of signatures from one ward.
Yeah.
No. Okay. Well, yours, yeah, yes. Yes.
So that way, you know, you would still be able to mount a campaign even if you were proposing something that was so uniformly at odds with the voters in any one or two particular wards.
Say it one more time.
That the signature requirement would be that you would have to get a minimum of 25 signatures from at least four wards.
Red?
No, in each of four wards.
In each of four wards.
Yeah.
They're counselors at large, not counselors almost at large. I think they should be required to get signatures from each ward.
But I'm concerned.
And anybody who's going to be running for an at large spot, I'm sure they have some type of machine going, and if they can't get 15 signatures from each ward, then I think they have a problem.
But Red, what about that example? Say that you're proposing to do something that is contrary to the views of, say, theoretically, that everybody in Ward 6.
So a smart politician wouldn't show all his cards. He would go out and he'd get the signatures, and then once he's on the ballot, then he can say what he wants and be voted up or down.
Yeah, but then the problem with that is the next time he goes for election, he's not going to get a signature from that ward. So
that's too bad.
So one ward can end a politician's career? Well,
so if you have, let's say you have all the signatures from four wards that reflect one thing that I might not agree with. So I have to live with it.
But no, all this is getting access to the ballot. Yeah. And it still is a way that you could, there still is a requirement that the person still win. But I just don't want to preclude somebody's opportunity for running just because he's promoting a position
that's
contrary.
Right. Make it 10. Make it 5. Well, I mean, they're at large. They're not almost at large.
I don't think that 15 really is going to knock anybody out.
Okay.
But I'm aware that theoretically it could.
Theoretically, there's a lot of theoreticals, but
that's what we have to
work. But you don't think it would knock anybody out? You can't.
Practically, no. Okay. But I do imagine that there would be the size of the wards that you could. This could be an issue.
Tom,
it doesn't. There's no ward requirement presently.
Right. Correct.
I don't know that we've suffered because there's no ward requirement. I don't see the need to complicate the charter by putting in a ward requirement. If somebody's going to win, they have to spread themselves out among all the wards. And if they can get on the ballot with their 100 signatures from three wards, so be it. Let them get out there and run. I don't see the need for a ward requirement. I think it unduly complicates a charter, and I don't see that we've ever had any problem with it in the past.
Megan?
Thomas Swain.
Gail?
I'm mixed in general. I lean against the ward requirement on the premise of let's be consistent before more participation. But I'm not adamant about it.
Betty?
Yeah, I agree. I don't think it's necessary, and I don't think we heard a lot of desire from it from the public. Only a couple people.
Mark?
There is still a value to having a potential candidate or a candidate show that he or she has been able to attract broader interest from just that particular ward, and which is a possibility. Maybe they're going to do that anyway. Collect signatures and Stop and Shop, great, I got all over the city. You know, and I also just look at what is the practice in other cities and towns. I like the idea of being able to show that you've been able to have some broader appeal if you're running for a citywide position. Is it a problem now? Maybe not. I don't know if there's anybody whose candidacy, somebody would have dropped out because they had to go to this extra requirement, or that we attracted people who weren't serious. I think it has some theoretical, some virtues in itself to go and call for a broader range of signatures.
Tom?
I'm concerned about the optics of making a change. We're already talking about increasing the number. Increasing and having a geographic requirement might send the wrong message. I understand where Mark's coming from. I can live with either.
I mean, I'm not a veto.
I can live with whatever's agreed upon. I have no problem. I mean, like you said, we've lived with it for now, but if we're changing the numbers, why not make it a little more appealing and have them allow them to get them? But I can live with whatever the rest of the group.
My interpretation of what I just heard was that we are having no geographic requirements.
Correct.
Okay. All right, another big piece done. Thank you, folks.
Oh, there was one other thing.
Yep.
This issue of this testimonial. We further state that we believe him to be a good moral character qualified to perform the duties of the office.
That's an administrative item. That can't be put in the charter.
But it is now. I mean, is there, if we're
it's
just
not in the charter.
The charter would be repealed.
But this isn't in the charter right now, but the charter replacement is, the charter replacement that's proposed with whatever signature requirement the city clerk or the city calls for. And the signatures using the form, where is it? Using the form, signatures of voters shall be made on a form prescribed by the registrar of voters to be made available no later
I don't want a form that includes a testimonial like this.
But I don't think that's appropriate to put in the charge.
Well, maybe it is appropriate because what he's saying is that we're making a statement as to the type of person that should run.
One way to say it, okay, it's not, perhaps this doesn't need, this isn't in the charter now. Actually, this isn't the charter now, but we can get rid of it. But you know, I would like then in our report to the council that we also include the recommendation that these testimonials be removed from the voter forms.
Consensus on that?
Yep.
Okay, 100% agreement on that, and again, you will be writing that section up. All right, I'm going to just turn this piece over to Gail.
Okay.
She's handed out lots of stuff. We're going to be moving into pre-petition initiative referendum and recall. Last night, on a quick consensus, we agreed that we would be keeping initiative and referendum. We were going to talk later about the number of signatures for each of those, but we would keep those as options within government, and we would spend time talking about pre-petition and recall and the signatures for all four areas. Gail, the floor is yours.
Okay, so let me just tell you what I did because I needed to do this for myself, and I'm thinking if I needed to, maybe it would probably help everybody think about these things. So I went through the current charter on each one of these four items. And that's what you have is two paper-clipped pieces and then two single pieces. The first paperclip one is the initiative petition. Current charter and page two of it is the proposed draft. And so we'll go through that issue by issue. The second paperclip piece you have is the referendum, current charter and proposed draft. And then the two single pieces are just proposed draft because the recall and the free petition are not in the current charter. Okay, so you see what you have?
Yes.
Okay. So let's go back to initiative petition first. And I'm just going to lay these side by side. What I did was, every time I saw an issue in the current charter, I put it in bold. So the bolded stuff, we just need to get through. The first, and this is a question for Steve, the first one, is in the current charter, the initiative petition section refers to chapters 164 and 166 of the general laws. And in the draft, you list certain kinds of issues that would be accepted from the initiative petition.
Correct.
Does the list take care of the reference to the
I wish we talked about this before. This is a 1954 initiative petition language, and this is
I just want to be sure that if we mean to have everything from the old 164 and 166 accepted, that we have it in that list. So
yes.
That's just
so the language I've proposed in all these have received repeatedly, have repeated Attorney General and Secretary of State approvals. So
what is 164 and 166? What are they referred to?
I have no idea. That's in the current chart.
The second piece is, I asked whether measure is defined, but when I see your new definitions, it is defined, so we don't have to worry about that. In the current charter, if the initiative petition is signed by at least 20% of registered voters, the council or the school committee has to do one of those two things within 20 days. And the new draft changes that. It requires 250 signatures, 25 from each ward, plus an affidavit by 10 people who will agree to be the petitioner, the petitions committee. What it goes on later to say that the petition has to go to the city clerk, and the city clerk has to take some steps, including returning the petition to the clerk of the committee, but it doesn't order the committee to elect a clerk and report that to the city clerk. So I would just recommend that that sentence be added.
Say
that again. Want me to say it again?
Yes. Yeah,
in the new draft,
yeah.
there's a requirement that the city clerk, when they go through the list of petition signatures, report back the results to the clerk of the petitions committee. But nowhere does it tell the petitions committee to elect a clerk and report the name of that person to the city clerk. Then the committee members have to get 15% of the voters as determined from the last election and return that petition to the city clerk within 30 days. That 15% is going to change when we go further down. You'll see it's less than the 20% required in the current charter, but it, in the proposed draft, this process has sort of like a second step and it gets more complicated. We're going to get back to the 20%. So I just want to point out that that difference of the 15% is going to get changed in a couple minutes. In the proposed draft, the city council or the school committee has three options with what to do with this petition, as opposed to the two options in the old charter. The council or the committee could pass the thing as is, or they could call a special election that would result in the petitions being accepted upon a majority vote. In the new draft, they could pass it as is, or they could pass what's called a measure in lieu of the proposal. So they could do some change in that proposal and pass that, and I suppose hope that it satisfies the petitioners.
That's a compromise type thing, yeah.
Or they could reject the proposal. Yeah. But if it's rejected, the city clerk has to notify the committee clerk. In the new proposal, if the council or a school committee fails to act within 30 days of receiving that measure, the measure is deemed rejected. Now, within 60, this is the second step that is added in the new proposal. Within 60 days of the rejection of an initiative petition, the original petitioners can file a supplemental initiative petition. They can only do that if the supplemental petition is signed by 5% of registered voters in addition to the original 15 that they had in their original petition. City clerk determines if the signatures are sufficient. Here's another question that I had. In some places throughout the draft, it's the registrar of voters who's deciding if the signatures are sufficient. Here, repeatedly, it's the city clerk. Any problem with that difference?
No, because in this city, the city clerk is on the board.
Is on the board, yeah. So it's okay.
It got merged in. That was one of the charter changes
early
on.
So no problem.
City clerk.
Isn't the current charter, there's no further stipulation if it doesn't pass?
Correct. No, you can't bring it again in the current charter.
If it doesn't pass, then it goes to, you can put it off to vote, can't you?
Well, that is the vote. It's the special election.
It's the special election. Would you explain what you just said about the city clerk and the registrar of voters?
They were separate departments at one particular point in time about, after Wendy took over, so 8 years ago, we merged those two departments, and the voter registration now is a sub-department underneath the city clerk's.
I think,
which is why we moved them next to each other physically.
Okay, for consistency, I think that it should either be the registrar of voters or city clerk all the way through. It shouldn't raise a question as to for the possibility of distinction.
All right, and so we should do a word search on this.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, and then under the new proposal, there's some other stuff in the current charter. I don't know if you want me to go into this kind of detail. I'm not going to, just to keep everybody sort of on track here, but if the city clerk determines that the signatures are sufficient, then there's to be a special election held not less than 35, not more than 90 days following the certification. But if there's a regular election within 120 days, you can use that instead and omit the special election. And there's a new requirement in the proposed draft that the full text of the initiative petition, proposed initiative petition, must be published in a newspaper of wide circulation, not less than 7 or more than 14 days before that election. Now here's another problem that I found, and I don't know if it is a problem, but I just wanted to raise it. The text in the current, in the proposed draft says that a majority of the persons voting in that special election passes the measure. That's a section H of the draft. But if you look further on the draft in section 8-6, it says that in addition to the majority, there has to have been 20% of the voters, of the registered voters as of the most recent city election, voting in that IP election. And so I wondered if section H should be amended to say, except as provided in section 8-6 below. Just so, because it's really hard when you read these things, you come to a certain place in the charter and it says it wins by majority. And then three paragraphs later, you find out that you had to have another requirement as well.
Is that a logistical nightmare? Well, let me ask it this way. What was it, 20%?
Mm-hmm.
So you have to figure out if the people voting on the special election, if at least 20% of those people voted in the previous election?
Well, not those people, a total of
20%. 20% should have, at least 20% of the total registered voters have to have voted for that.
Okay, so it's not the individuals.
Wait, I read that differently. I read 20% of the number of people who voted in the previous election.
That's true.
Not 20%.
Right. That's how you get the number.
Okay, but it's not 20% of registered voters. If only 50% of registered voters vote in November and you have an initiative in January, you need then 20% of that 50, so only 10% of registered voters effectively.
Yeah.
However, I think that I'm not totally sure that there are places throughout the proposed charter in which we say X percent of the registered voters without a reference back to that last election, and that's another check that we should do, because otherwise you don't have anything to go on. They all have to refer back to the previous, the most recent election.
But this is a required voter participation to for none of this can take effect until unless 20% of the voters from the previous election could have voted on that. It doesn't matter how many percent voted yes or no.
No, but what I'm saying is there are multiple places in the draft where you are asking the clerk to calculate a percentage of the registered voters for some purpose, and each time I think it has to refer back to the previous election, otherwise it's a meaningless phrase. Or the clerk is put in a position of having to figure out the 20% of the registered voters on the date that she's calculating.
So you're saying there needs to be a date stamp.
There just needs to be the words as of the most recent regular
signature. Added wherever. As of the most,
so it's not 20% of all the registered voters, it's 20% of the people that voted in the most recent.
No.
That's my confusion, yeah. Is it 20% of registered voters at the last election, or 20% of the number of the turnout at the last election?
At least 20% of the voters as of the most recent regular city election. Which that means not who have voted, 20% of the registered voters.
Okay.
Oh,
okay.
That's
okay.
Totally
that's
a much higher. Registered as of that
18,000, give or take. So 20% would be
3,800.
Okay.
Yeah. And Steve and I talked about this the other night. Some place where it refers to the most recent election, other places it refers to the most recent regular election. and an election. And so I think that we want it to be consistent.
Yes. Just as another piece of background, I don't know if that's what you were doing over there, Bill, but I Googled in section 70, has to do with opening streets by gas companies, so I'm not quite sure how that...
It's chapter 164?
164.
The other problem is the numbers could have changed. I mean, if it's a 1954 draft, the numbers of the
code. It's useless to read it, but
so
I'm telling you
right
today, when, was
to your question.
I said, I shut the computer.
Okay, so that I'm sorry to be this confusing, but that I just needed to do that for me.
Okay.
So just to clarify, for about 3,600 voters would need to participate in an initiative vote in order for it to be a valid election.
Correct. You mean need to sign the petition?
No. To vote in the special election.
I mean, if you don't have at least 3,600 people voting, it doesn't pass.
Just for perspective, when we had the override recently, we cleared that. It was close to 50%. It was like our regular municipal elections. It wasn't a big drop. So I think that 20% is not that tough a bar to clear. That's pretty low.
What's interesting about it, though, is that if you don't support the referendum, not voting might be as effective as voting no,
sure.
Or more effective.
Sure. It's like the Arab Spring, you boycott when the
right.
Thing's rigged.
Well, that's
somewhat. That's an odd twist.
So you're better off, exactly, if you
stay
don't,
home.
If
you'll
don't support it,
home.
Don't vote. And so you could get 100% of the voters in favor of the initiative, but it's still not passed.
That's assuming that all the voters even understand this.
Well,
but you're still
that's the point. I mean, it should be something that people can understand.
And then what you're saying is then you need 3,600 supporters to show up. And the worst case scenario, you'd have to have 3,600 votes to pass an initiative over the council, to basically overrule the council.
This should be difficult.
Yeah. Yeah, but it should be clear as to what needs to be done. I mean, I was saying that that it should be easy to pass an initiative, but people should understand what needs to be done.
So let me just play this out again as I try to play devil's advocate. 1801 and 1799. So 1801 people vote yes to override. 1799 vote no. You hit your threshold of your 20%. 1801 people have just overridden the city council.
It's the minimum.
That's your most ridiculous scenario.
Yeah, and the maximum would be 3,600.
Okay. Just want to make sure that we've got the parameters on here.
But if those 1,800 voted yes, the 1,700 boycotted.
Right. That's
They would lose.
Which is Valley's point.
But this is a big deal. People are collecting signatures. And this is not something that's just not all over the newspapers, and it's not something that's it's not something that's used very often.
Very.
Okay, so on this particular one, initiative petition, it has been laid out very nicely by Gail. Do you have any additional questions about it? We've cleaned up the wording that Steve will handle. Bill. Maddie.
I have a minor concern that it's not unforeseeable that in 20 years the town does not have a newspaper anymore.
Excuse me?
That the town no longer have a newspaper.
Yes.
And therefore, to have it as a requirement in the charter that the city has to put in a newspaper is a little awkward.
This has come up before.
Oh, good.
You might have mentioned. What would happen in that instance is that the state will pass a law applicable to all cities and towns saying that this is what replaces the newspaper. Because every child, all over, the state will pass it, so we'll see all this.
But why does the word newspaper have to be there? Why can't we publish it on the website?
In the meantime, just put phone news, text and newspaper, and city website.
I think because the law requires newspapers still.
Okay.
Because we may not have websites.
No, it's a newspaper law.
That
law would not be changed. I mean,
Put it in the Buffalo Times. It doesn't even say the local.
Newspaper generally circulates.
Okay. The National Enquirer.
Yeah. Any other questions or comments about the wordsmithing this particular piece of the document? Are we comfortable with it? Do we have a consensus that we are going to adopt this as a citizen initiative?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Maddie?
Yes. More of a general statement. How close are you, Steve, to have made all in making all the changes that we've come up with so far, so that you could provide us with everything that we've discussed and talked about?
I'm up to date as of last night.
Is it possible to, because we have a meeting tomorrow night.
Right.
We won't meet again until
Tuesday.
Is it possible to give us what you have so far, so that if we have a chance to read it, and if there's anything in there that's glaring, we would be able to discuss it?
Yep. So can I have that tomorrow morning first thing, or when do you get to the hotel?
Sure.
Okay.
So you've got three notes on...
I'm not sure I'll get to this.
Right, I understand. Not what we're doing tonight, but I mean, what we've done the last couple of nights.
Okay, so initiative petition. My read of consensus of this group is that we have adopted it as proposed, and the language is amended and suggested by Gail. Moving forward to...
Wait.
Oh, sorry.
I still want to go. The issue is you sold the 25 from each ward. Is that a conflict with what we talked about with regard to the at-large mayor position?
Do you want to pick up on that? Todd, for your piece, it was just pointed out that in the current wording of initiative petition, it requires there's a ward allotment, a ward requirement in terms of signatures. Should that remain, given that we did not consider that for elections? Anyone? Gail?
Well, I don't find it nearly as offensive in this context, for the very reason that the whole initiative process is an attempt to override the decision of an elected body. So I think it's okay.
No, an initiative is not a referendum.
No, well, but I mean, but the city council or the school committee has to have acted on that before it goes to
goes to the 25 from each ward.
The issue could be ward based, actually.
So we're comfortable with keeping in the ward requirement. Is that the consensus of the group? Maddie?
I think it's to have a higher threshold. It's like an apple and an orange. It's not about, I don't have a problem with that.
Okay. The consensus would be that particular language stays, that this has been adopted as amended as a citizen initiative. Next.
Now we're going to switch to referendum. The current charter, it exists in the current charter, and it's to repeal an existing measure of the city council or the school committee. In the current charter, it had to be filed within 20 days of the passage of the protested measure. In the new draft, it's 21 days. And there's just a typo in there, Steve. It's just the word of that needs to come out. You'll see it when you follow it. This petition under the current charter had to have the signatures of 12% of the registered voters. In the new one, it's 15% of the voters as of the date of the most recent regular city election. So that's the same couple of issues. Both provisions provide that upon the filing, the protested measure is suspended. And both provide that the council or school committee must immediately reconsider the protested measure. There's a very odd piece in the current charter. It says, if I'm reading it correctly, that the school committee or the council must schedule a special election or wait until the next city election at the discretion of the council or the school committee. It kind of cures it by saying that the proposed repeal becomes void.
They already have to suspend the
So that the discretion part is weird. That's taken out in the new one. It says that if it's not rescinded, the council must schedule the special election. It can do it at its convenience or at a time requested by the school committee or at the next regular city election, but the proposed measure remains suspended until election. And I assumed that the school committee itself, that it's written that way because the school committee itself wouldn't have the authority to schedule the special election, but the council does. Then, for the referendum, the procedures remain the same as they are with the initiative petition. And let me see, on my note, we've taken care of the first one. So, in section 8-4 of the new draft, there's a list of measures which are not appropriate for a referendum. And I just had a question about two of them. Is the seventh listed issue, Steve, just there so that we don't keep having repeated circling back to referenda?
Right.
Okay. And in the eighth listed issue, it's just an odd statement. After the word referral, it doesn't say a referral of what? Do we need anything that says referral of a measure or anything? Or is it clear?
I mean, like, as I said, this language is, test of time.
So it's okay?
I think so.
Okay. Okay. Those are my only thoughts about this one.
Can I ask a question about the discretion issue? Sort of interests me because it sounds a bit like a pocket veto, that the council, it's a face-saving way. If the council doesn't want to go through having an election, the cost, the hassle, they can basically make the whole issue go away. They had to rescind or suspend whatever measure, but they don't necessarily have to put it to a vote. They could just
under the current charter.
Under the current charter. What's the disadvantage of keeping that kind of language, given that it does provide a face-saving way for the council to back off without having to go through the expense and the rancor, perhaps, of a general election?
Well, because I think in the referendum, they have plenty of chances to reconsider.
So if a referendum process starts, they get their votes, they have a right to their election, regardless of what the council does. If the council backs off, does the election...
They won't.
No.
They won't without the expense of the election.
Okay, so the council can... Oh,
yes.
Okay.
Still
oh,
yes.
Okay.
Have that.
Okay, it doesn't have to be still done
yeah.
because it's implicit.
Yeah.
Okay, gotcha.
Okay, so some of the big changes again. Why 20 to 21 days? Just to... Right. And 50% of what goes up from 12 to 50% of the number of signatures that are required of the most recent regular city election.
Yeah, that's that same issue.
Okay. Because again, it's the date of the most recent voters. That language has to be clear. Is it voters who voted at the election or
registered voters?
It's registered voters.
Okay, so we have to do obviously a word search to make sure that is consistent throughout. Any discussion on what has been proposed and reviewed by Gail? Getting a consensus or getting a sense of the community? How do we feel about this subtle changes that have been made to referendum? Running the room, starting with Bill?
Fine.
Yeah.
Mark?
Pass for a moment.
Okay.
Let me, I'm still not clear on this discretion. I'm thinking of face-saving ways. Under this referendum, it's presented to the council or the school committee. If they don't act to permanently suspend it, it goes to a vote. There's no option for them to sort of permanently table it and avoid
how
an election.
Is permanently tabling it and suspending it different?
Because this forces them to either reconsider it, which means vote it up or down again.
Right.
And if they don't vote it, if they don't repeal it, it goes to election. So I'm sort of offering an intermediate way where they wouldn't have to vote to repeal it, but they could vote to never take it up again, and they just remain permanently suspended. I'm wondering if that option has any utility for the city.
I think repeal and suspending are two different things.
But this forces repeal, or you have an election.
Correct. And, you know.
But meanwhile, it's suspended, so the people got what they wanted.
Until the election occurs.
Until the election, and then the election's at the discretion of the council, who could just choose to not have an election, and then that's the face-saving measure.
But then, what happens when the next city council comes in? It's got a suspended measure.
I think that would die at the end of the city council.
Would it? That's the answer.
I don't know.
If there's no carryover,
have to reintroduce everything. Of an ordinance that they passed once that's now suspended?
Suspended is, there's no carryover.
Well, there's probably never, there's no precedence for this stuff. This is not an ordinance. This is something under a referendum procedure that's, you know, state law, and why do we go around?
Okay. So it's not workable then, because the suspension would expire, would kick back in. Okay, I just was wondering if there.
It might expire, but even if it didn't expire, it's a real weird thing to hand on to your predecessors forever—a suspended law with no good chance of
election. It has to be reintroduced. I'll stay corrected on that. But Meg,
I'm comfortable with the changes.
Brent,
yes,
yeah,
fine.
Okay. Hearing the consensus in the room, the referendum.
Still, Marcus.
Mark, I'm sorry.
No, is there anything that would affect the timing? You know, that the city council with this issue of discretion would be gaming it in order not to get a vote, but I don't think it's necessary to go and add in additional language. So yeah, I'm fine with it.
Okay. Thank you. We are moved through an accepted referendum as we were. Yeah.
Next we have a recall.
Pre-petition?
You want to do pre-petition first? Okay, pre-petition. It's not in the current charter. The way the proposed draft works is that a petition has to be signed by at least 100 voters. Now, my own note on this is not making sense to me now. Do you have it in front of you? Is that what it says, 100 voters?
100, yeah.
Okay, then forget my, forget that parentheses. That doesn't make any sense. The city council or the, and it can be seeking the passage of any measure, anything that the petition wants. The city council or the school committee has to hold a public hearing and take action. They have to hold the hearing and take action, both, no later than 6 weeks after the petition is filed with the city clerk or the secretary of the school committee. Then the city clerk or the secretary of the school committee has at least at least 7 days before the hearing, mail notice of the hearing to the first 10 people named on that petition. Notice by publication of all such hearings is at the public expense, but the draft doesn't mandate publication and it doesn't give a time frame for it.
But the open meeting
law
That's what, okay.
What does take action mean?
Say yes or no.
They do not have to accept it.
But they would have to vote it down?
They would have to take some sort of a vote.
A vote of tabling would actually count.
Yeah.
Or not a vote, but a tabling there.
Or referring it to subcommittee?
Yeah.
Okay.
And is that the end of it then?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm nervous about what this could do to the workings of the council. If the agenda could be very easily cluttered by a very small group of people determined to be unruly. At minimum, I think 100 votes threshold is way too low for this, if you do it at all. And even if you don't have this, it's not like you can't petition your city councilor. You don't need to have it in the charter I've organized a petition and brought it to the council myself without having it in the charter. And if you get a lot of signatures and the council blows you off, well, that's a political risk that they're taking if there's a real sincere groundswell for something. But to force them to have hearings and votes when the group you're might actually not be all that representative of the constituency, and they and that same group could go again and again and again to cause trouble, I think they make the council business very unworkable.
More comments? Please.
I go along with Bill. I'm worried that you could have a lot of referendums to save the baby seals, you know, do resolutions dealing with Myanmar, you know, that you could turn Northampton City Council into what actually what I experienced living in Cambridge County, which is constantly filled with these referendums. They don't really do any city business. And I think if I were a city councilor, I would really resent these referendums, these initiatives. Maybe this is all moot anyway, because maybe these really wouldn't show up. But you know, I'd just be reticent to just allow this level of access. I'm wondering though, what is the case if you are a city councilor, you really feel like, look, this is such a waste of my time. I ran to go and deal with potholes in Northampton, and I'm forced to go and sit through this. Could I, is there something that says that the public hearing actually has to reach a quorum of the councilors? I mean, if this is what the councilors want to do, but if they don't want to do it and they walked away.
Every time that we take votes on issues that are outside the city, there is always newspaper articles or letters to the editor saying that it's not the business of the city.
Yeah, positions on
ending the war in Iraq or whatever that we might all agree on, but it's not the city council.
It's not a municipal issue.
It's not a municipal issue is the word I'm trying to come up with. So is there a way, I hear what you're saying, is there a way to pick up on Emily's point, though, about having citizen input to provide that these petitions can't be on Save the Whales, they have to be on business germane to city issues.
How do you write that?
How do you do that? The rock war, people bring it home. It's about spending and budget constraints. So everything's fungible.
Yeah. And there's people that feel that the doing votes of the war are important. I happen to disagree, but I know that people feel very strongly the opposite way.
What is the genesis of this repetition language?
It's just been another Troutism. It's just there as a thing to discuss.
Something to look at. Okay.
Some people have it, some people don't.
Did we hear any interest in our forums?
Other than Emily.
Oh, I think there are some cases left.
Oh, sorry.
Thank you,
Paces.
Yes.
I
support it, but I'd be willing to go up in the signatures if that helps move it along.
Yeah.
So then, if we went up on the signatures, how would it differ in substance from the initiative petition? Because in the initiative petition, in the proposed draft, the city council or school committee has the chance to pass such a proposal or to amend it and pass it. So
the free petition can never make it onto the ballot.
Pardon? Yeah, it has no legs. I mean, all it is like a hearing, right?
Right,
but what I'm saying is they get the same hearing within the process of the initiative petition.
They get the hearing, but they can't ever force it beyond that, right? So therefore, I would like it to stay under the number of votes of the initiative.
Literature you circulated, if I remember correctly, only a few towns had the free petition. You had a chart of two pages and only a handful.
Yeah.
Why is that? Just hasn't been adopted, or it's something new, or
it's something newer than the other things, and probably been put in the end to give an easier way so people will go right to the citizen initiative or the referendum. It's maybe. In the end, maybe, you know, it's like a first step type of thing, like a grievance process, you know, step one, step two. That's probably why it's there, but, you know, you're right, a lot of places just don't want to deal with this, and it depends on the character of the municipality, too, and how active the people are, like a place like Cambridge, this thing would be probably very problematic.
It's almost like there's 100 signatures. An old town meeting rule, almost, you know.
Yeah,
right. Other comments on this? We do need to come to move on.
I kind of like it, but I think we should increase the signatures.
Pick
I like
a number.
The idea of it.
Pick a number.
300.
Okay. me.
Yeah.
You're still a concern.
I would take 300.
And up 3,000.
And I would make it more explicit that the mayor's items get put directly on the agenda too. I don't think it's right that the council president puts it on the agenda, the urgent people put it on the agenda, but the mayor's position is a little fuzzier.
Interesting.
Well,
I thought we got the mayor.
If we feel that's ironclad already, then fine. I know that's a little fuzzy, that sort of consultation.
Yeah. Apples and oranges. I'm going to take that off the table only because it's apples and oranges. I hear what you're saying, apples and oranges. I want to say a free petition and arguing with something else makes me uncomfortable.
Well, I just want to point out again that the current charter, this is not part of it. So it still is it would be not unacceptable, which isn't necessarily to say it is acceptable, but it's not unacceptable. Unreasonable idea to say that we could still yield to the default of just leaving it out.
Where are you?
We're staying aside. I don't like it, but you know, people think it's important.
Yeah?
I'm stand aside too. I don't think it's a great idea to put it in. I agree with Bill that it has a chance to really disrupt the business of the city. But if there's a strong consensus for it, I won't stand in line.
I'll stand aside also for the same reasons that she said.
But
I agree.
All three of you are opposed to it, but you'll stand aside if there's
yes.
strong opinions going
yes.
the other
I don't
way.
Think we're trying to streamline the charter. Start adding more stuff here almost, and I know it's a new thing and everything, but I think we've managed quite well without it. And if you do have a problem, you can go to your counselor now. And
Megan?
I do like the idea of it, but I will also stand aside.
I'm in the opposition stand aside group.
Okay.
So,
you see the wind on this one.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
I stand aside.
But you're in the opposition stand aside.
Sure, I'm happy to let it die.
No, no, but we're four opposed, but
congenial
okay. one in favor. So
one more, and we don't have to
stand aside. I'm aside to
the one down here.
Well,
you know, so the question is, are you in favor of it or against it?
All right, I'm against adding it to the charter.
Okay.
But I would stand.
Then I get to, and I we know where you are.
I'd be against, but I'd accept 300 as a compromise.
Maddie and Megan, as proponents of this, are you, is this on the chart? Where are you in this chart? And since the consensus, the consensus is to not include this in the chart.
So now I'm speaking in a double negative. Well, I like it. I would put it at 150 signatures, but I'm not going to, I can see no one else likes it enough or at all, so I'm certainly not going to stand in the way.
My call to the consensus, which is interpretation, is that we are not going to be including free petition in the charter. Recall. Good luck with this one.
We should just go around the room first and see. Can we take a temperature on it?
Yeah.
First?
Who believes in recall? Anybody? Anybody against recall?
I'm against recall.
All right. Wait. Who agrees? And everybody raises their hand. Who's against recall?
Oh, wait.
All right. Okay. Fine. That's great.
Next question.
Recall is not going to be recall is not going to be a charter. Gail's points and clarifications in her email, you will make sure are there were no wordsmithing changes
in that,
right?
Were you
absolutely.
If there's no recall,
Recall is not going to be.
Right. Sorry.
Gail, I may send you a draft before.
Okay.
So you'll.
Then I won't throw my notes in.
Todd.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yes, you can.
You changing your vote? No, but I just want to point out, I mean, there was still the issue that came up that when the mayor was at 2-year terms, there was no need for recall because, well, we can all live with it for another year. But if the consensus has been 4 years from there, does that change this? Does it?
I actually want to, if we're going to reopen the discussion.
Okay.
I would quickly just tell you that in the current draft of recall, you aren't allowed to bring a recall petition until somebody's been in office for 6 months, and you're not allowed to bring a recall petition during the last 6 months of someone's term. So taken together, that reduces the amount of time in which a recall petition is appropriate to 3 years. So even if we extend the mayor's term to 4, which we're recommending, the mayor only serves one more year than the mayor would have in a 2-year term if we have recall. Does that make any sense? So you're really talking about a 1-year window of change if you adopt recall. So that to me, the 4-year change doesn't make a lot of difference for the recall.
Well, plus the 6, you can't bring a recall within 6 months, and there's other processes that, you know, have to be, you have to get an election, that's another 30 to 90 days probably, and then it just adds up and adds up and adds up. And then if you fail at the recall, you can't do another recall for 270 days.
Okay, but we have come to a consensus.
Yes.
The recall is not on the table, and it will not be in the charter. Moving forward, I turn to Todd and the consideration of compensation. Now, Todd sent a memo around today that I refer you all to take a look at. I have some wording of something that I would like to propose when you finish your introduction.
I sent around a memo that mainly dealt with my concerns about conflicts of interest, which is only a portion of what we're addressing here. We're also looking at salaries for mayor, council members, and school committee members, and whether those should be adjusted. And I would suggest that perhaps we start with the mayor, which is a little bit different, and we can move mayor, council, school committee, and address those separately unless someone else has
Before we get into the specifics of debating the 90,000, 50,000, whatever we're going through, can we talk about the concept that has been raised about this potentially being the 800-pound gorilla, the poison pill, whatever the word is of it, and are we at the point of wanting to tackle that as part of the charter? There are ways that we can deal with this in regarding the charter. We can ignore it and let them deal with it on their own. We can put a mechanism in for them, which I'll read you my suggestion, or we can actually get to the specifics as starting points for them. Okay, Maddie?
Well, I heard people say during our PowerPoint that we couldn't even change our position, so I'm a little confused about it.
The charter can set the limits. Pat Goggins was the one who specifically said, no, you can't. So I think you're right. I'm gray on that as well. But if I may, with Steve back in the room, every 10 years prior to the city's debate of the fiscal year ending in 5, an independent commission comprised of representatives from each ward and 2 at large, appointed by the mayor and approved by the city council, shall review the salary and compensation package of all elected officials. Any recommendations for change, recording a 2/3 majority vote, will be sent to the city council for enactment by a simple majority. The reason I'm suggesting this is that we could put a change in now, and then 10 years from now, the mayor's salary is going to be out of whack. So whatever I would suggest we put in is some type of a mechanism that allows for some process that takes out of the hands of the elected officials and the conflict of interest, and allows the general public, a committee like ourselves, to set that compensation package.
And the committee is chosen or selected by the mayor? And
you would know that you would ask to be on the committee, and just like we asked to be on the committee and choose it. That's the fuzzy part for me. I don't care about that part of it. Okay. But I don't know how you pick a committee other than this. Okay. But you would take it to a commission. They do it every 10 years. The reason I'm taking it out of putting it on the 5-year versus a 10-year is because the charter is on the 10. So the charter review is on the 10. That's how we got established. It says in the ordinances, charter gets reviewed every 10 years, how we got established as a committee. This would be set up as an independent commission every 5 years to bring a recommendation forward. It needs a 2/3 vote. That's iffy for me as well. Goes to the city council, they do the approving, but it takes it out of the hands of the elected politicians. An option.
I hear where you're coming from. In the private sector, most boards have special compensation committees, and those are notoriously beholden to the chief executive. So I'm not sure that they're really an effective way to implement necessary changes and to do things. I think they're abused, and that would be my concern. I understand the dynamic you're trying to set up. But
and remember that this would be subject to a referendum. If the folks don't like it, they can collect the signatures and pull it back. So there's a safety mechanism built into that. But I'm just trying to take it out of the politician's hands. Because once we establish it, okay, we can establish a rate. Okay, we're going to pay the mayor $100,000. And we're going to go to $20,000 or $10,000 for city council. At some point during the next, that's going to be absolutely.
I agree with you, David. I think the council has shown an ability and willingness to adjust the mayor's salary as needed. So that's not really an issue. And I think Steve made a comment early on that he thought the mayor's salary was absurd. And you know, the problem with that, it is on the low end, but if the logic is you always have to be, you know, above average, then you sort of get this leapfrogging that you see in the private sector where no one wants to be in the bottom,
right,
you know, two quartiles. So I'm unhappy with leaving the council. I mean, I would suggest that we don't touch them. We could make a recommendation that council evaluate the salary, but I don't think we should recommend an increase in the mayor's salary, because that's in the purview of an elected body like the council to do. They've shown an ability to do it. I don't see that's our business. That's my personal, given that the mayor's salary specifically.
Okay.
And I want to add to that, I don't think we've done the proper research as the compensation committee would do to determine what would be an appropriate salary for the mayor.
Which is why I'm setting up this special committee to do it.
The problem is there's no research that's valid.
We put the comments.
Yeah, but it's
true. But the mayoral compensation is not science. It's all politics. There's no studies behind it.
Why are city managers paid 25-30% higher?
Professional organization
than mayors.
Cherry-picking data.
Elected official is getting, you know, a third less than a
if you look at the mayoral compensation in the Pioneer Valley, they're all within a few thousand dollars of each other. That's what keeps down Springfield. You know, and he's barely making 100, I think, for running a city of that complexity.
Gail, you had your hand up?
I have questions for Steve about this. The main question is, what's the best practice in charters for dealing with this issue? And then some sub-questions. Does it have to be in a charter at all? Is it a charter issue?
It is a charter issue, mostly in the elected charter commissions. The elected charter commissions usually put in the transition provisions that the initial salary for the office of mayor under this charter shall be whatever. And same for the council, same for the school committee. They usually do that because it's a whole, you know, it's a whole new government and they're elected themselves. And you know, they can and they kind of take that first initial thing out of the political arena, which kind of does a favor for the incumbent office holders. For committees like this, I mean, I don't know. I mean, the last committee that wasn't elected, I think they did put a salary in for the initial compensation. But there's really no best practice. It's just all over the map. So, I mean, in this situation where there was a committee that recommended another committee, and that's your committee, and then this has to now go to the council, maybe you just, I don't want to use the word punt it, but maybe you just be silent on it and let it go through the political process. Or the way to deal with that, and I walked in and David was reading something and it sounded like some official committee, that you put in the transition provisions that the city council, or the mayor, whatever it is, shall be required to pass an ordinance that creates a committee that deals with this issue. That's how they do it in Somerville. It's a kind of mega committee of very respected business people, and they get together once every 5 years, and they
and they figure this out. And
this, that's the language I was trying to create.
And everybody feels comfortable with that. That it's not, you know, it's not all rigged, and it's hard to take politics out of the conversation in a political environment. You can only go so far. I mean, you can take this and say, well, the compensation for the elected officials in Northampton will be determined by Smith College. I mean, and then you take it all out of politics. But you know, it's impossible to take it completely out because someone has to do the appointing. How do you get around that?
So, should we, as a charter drafting committee, put numbers anywhere? School committee, city council, mayor, clerk, or should we punt to a commission, or should we let it go completely? Those are the three options I've heard so far. Anybody else want to put more on the table? Mark?
Well, there's numbers if you decide some numbers, and we have heard a lot of testimony about some things that is this something you do for the city council, for instance, something you do for the compensation, or is it something you do as a citizen, you know, for the privilege of this level of public service? I think it is, or we have heard enough, we may be in a position where we can speak wisely, at least with backing evidence, to suggest a philosophy. That maybe that, and the issue about should the compensation include certain benefits. You know, you could do it without even putting in a number, but you could still, you know, reflect some of what we've heard.
Gail, you had your hand up?
It was just a question. What did the previous committee recommend to us to do? I just can't
Nothing.
Remember.
I don't think
the
committee
came up. Oh, the previous committee? Yeah.
Didn't, it wasn't in there?
No. Megan?
In Congress, they just get an annual cost of living increase, and then a couple of years they say, oh, we're not going to take it this year. Is there anything like that? Any charters do something like that? Just so there's no number in there, but it just an allowance.
You base it on the Social Security COLA or some other number.
It's like a starting point if you do that.
Where they are now.
I mean, where they are right now is too low.
The $5,000, I think, was 1980 something.
Right.
And they created that.
Oh, so I was talking for mayor. I know if we wanted to keep raising this.
Yeah. But the city council and school committee, I think the push that I was hearing from you is that those potentially could be too low.
Yeah, I guess, you know, my concern is expressed in the document is I'm concerned about the conflicts of interest. And if we were to strip some of that from compensation. I'm not anti-compensation. I would want to make it up with that in terms of salary. Because otherwise I think it sounds punitive and I don't think it's productive to strip compensation. I just want to limit the type of compensation. That's my concern. Mm-hmm. So it's more of a sweetener to any changes that we might make or consider. I'm not sure how we do one without the other.
Tom?
Are we talking about specifying in this document a compensation for city officials, specific compensation? If so, I don't think it's appropriate. I mean, I like the idea of specifying in the document that there shall be a pentannual committee established by the city council consisting, and now we know if you have to go as to as to who it should consist of, to review compensation of all, but I wouldn't leave it at just the mayor and the city council. Well, maybe you should, the mayor and the city council.
Well, you got the clerk who's elected still,
right, the clerk.
And the school committee. So those are the four that I'm aware of that get compensation.
Well, why couldn't the council set the school committees? It's not there, then it wouldn't be a conflict
That's
of interest.
That's the way it is now. It's written out there now. The council sets the
school. Because that's not a conflict of interest for them to set it for themselves or setting it for someone else. They can set it for various boards.
So I just was, the one option was just to kick it to this commission and let the, you know, however we define the commission is another thing.
But I mean, if we put something in the charter, to me it could be very inflexible. And you want to have it reviewed. Who knows what benefits are going to be appropriate 30, 40 years from now.
If we have single payer that provide health insurance, wouldn't necessarily be appropriate. So,
I'm wondering if we could do a combination of a broad statement of, was it Utah who said, can we state the philosophy in think it was, I can't remember who said that, but something about the concerns that you're showing here, that in order to minimize putting our elected officials in a conflict of interest position, and you know, the others, maybe one or two of the main things that you're saying here, and then adopt the Somerville language, is that a way to combine these concerns and not touch numbers?
The concern I have with that, though, is you're basically making, this is a power that an elected body currently has, and you're saying we're going to take this power out of an elected body and put it in a non-elected body? Is that the direction we want to head?
But you can't entirely take it out because it's subject to appropriation if the council starts appropriating money.
But doesn't this...
My motion sets it back to the city council
for approval.
51...
But doesn't this... So are we trying to give the council sort of an easy out so that they don't have to raise this and take a vote on it?
I'm trying to get...
It was presented...
I'm just trying to have professionals do... And I know it's lay people, but I like the Somerville model where the professionals literally figure out, hey, you know, this is what we should be paying our folks.
I mean, can you make that commission as ridiculous that they have to be CPAs or actuaries or something like that?
I think I would leave it flexible.
Yeah. Because I also think you have to put a few taxpayers on there, too, who are going to say, hey, wait a minute now. I'm getting $22,000 a year in you know, my benefits as a retired person here, and my mortgage is $4,000, or my, you know.
I think we have to, unless I'm misunderstanding something you're saying, I think we have to accept the fact that there's an inherent conflict of interest in the city council's position, because they've got to approve appropriations which include appropriations to themselves. So that's a given. And it seems like what we're trying to do is reduce as much as we can, they're being put in that conflict position. So even though they have to be the final yay or nay sayers, at least we would be putting a buffer in between there with some independent, hopefully wise, professionals and citizens to make the recommendation. And I think that's
that, yeah, that would address the conflict of interest, the transparency issue as well, which is big. Who amongst us knew that council members and school committee members got health insurance before we sat down?
And my concern was, theoretically, counselors are part-time, school committee members are part-time, yet we don't offer part-time people under 19 hours those benefits in the city. And it's like, wait a minute, why are one group getting, not getting another, you know? So just that bothers me.
When the city council got their increase the last time, how was it handled then? Because I can't remember. It's been a long number of years since they did, but they had to go through a process for it.
Right. Well, somehow they're piggybacking on city employees' benefits.
To raise their salary?
Yeah, and they're, yeah.
Well, not salary, but
raise their compensation.
Compensation. Compensation.
And not all of them take the compensation package.
Right.
Because they're available of what? It's health?
Health, about half of them, four, about five, take the health.
Yeah.
So four of them don't even take the health, and I think two of those five take family, family policy, which is worth about $15,000.
Yeah.
So some are getting zero in health, some are getting the equivalent of $15,000. I think only one or two at max take life.
Should that be, I think Todd's point all along is that should be part of the package and give a set number to people. If they want to buy in, they can buy in at the discounted rate, sort of the COBRA kind of argument.
Or at least allow them, make it something that they have to stand in front of the cameras and vote on instead of sort of...
So where are we at? We could do nothing because we don't have to do anything. We can... set numbers and put it in the language that you talked about of saying the city council will be $10,000, the school committee will be $5,000, or whatever numbers we create with X benefits, whatever numbers we create. We can cherry pick and put it on certain salaries, or we can do it across the board of elected officials. We can send it to a commission.
Can I offer one more?
Yep.
We can present principles, leave it up to some committee to go and establish what it would be, but the numbers would be. We can set principles that our counselors and committee members, school committee, are citizens first. This is not meant to be their full-time job. We do not feel that there is there are issues of conflict of interest and perhaps equity among the people serving these positions to have benefits as part of it, and it may be contrary to the notion of this, these being part-time positions anyway. You know, those type of things. I stuck in my comments before the idea that, no, we shouldn't feel bad to suggest that that this should not be meant to provide full-time compensation for somebody. This is not, this is still something that is a privilege, and that we're not being improper to say that this is limited to people who have the wherewithal for public service.
I would just have to say, Mark, I respectfully disagree with you. I think that the salary for counselors is way too low. And I think they're all, you know, very smart to stand up here and say, I do it for God and country, you know, and I hardly need the money. Today I already put in 10 hours. I mean, if your other job is waitressing, I mean, how could you run for city council? I think that the statistics show that city council rate is abysmal. It's a nominal amount of money. I mean, I think people said it doesn't even cover their expenses of Xeroxing and stuff, you know. So I don't know what the solution is. I hear the complications, but if we're going to have a value statement about things, you know, I'm not going to go with 1,000 points of light like everybody's a volunteer. I totally disagree with that.
Can I just bring up one thing?
Yep.
I'm sorry. I understand, Matt, and this is a fair issue to say, are we precluding some service? But the other thing I think is it's not the salary that precludes the waitress or somebody who's serving, it's the time requirements. And that maybe there should be somebody to say, look, you know, let's do what we can as a city or as a charter drafting committee to not add responsibilities to the city council or the school committee. You know, or that we should promote the idea of streamlining the process or somehow, you know, it's not the dollar amount, it's the 40 hours a week that leads both people not to be able to go and do this.
But we just gave them maybe more work by saying that now they're going to be chairing their own committee. So, I mean, I think that, you know, it's
well, that might support, I mean, there was added requirements now for the city council president, and perhaps that would justify a higher compensation.
Well, that person currently gets $500 more a year. Well, they get $5,500. Megan, I saw your hand.
I feel like there's so many issues we're talking about right now that we're trying to remember my response to all of them. But I agree with Maddie that the city council is drastically underpaid. I think that it is a major barrier to somebody like me. I do not want to be on the city council. But I could never be on the city council because it wouldn't cover childcare or Xeroxing. Both of those. So I would recommend that we put in a dollar amount and a mechanism for it to continue to raise, whether that is a COLA or a commission. Also, about the benefits package, I do agree that there is a conflict there, that they are voting on their own benefits packages. But I think taking away health insurance is going in the wrong direction, even though it is a part-time position. I'm conflicted on this one. I kind of go either way, but I feel that offering health insurance is just one thing that we can at least do for people that are volunteering so much time. And just taking away health insurance is just going in the wrong direction of where I want the society to go.
Well, I would clarify with the health reforms that we have, if you're poor, working class, you have access to subsidized, even free health care. If you're employed, you presumably have, I mean, 97% of Massachusetts citizens are insured. So I can understand 20 or 10 years ago mm-hmm. when individuals like myself had a real tough time outside of a group accessing the health insurance system. That's gone. So I think that argument, I understand that argument, but I think if you examine it, it may not be as valid as it might have been 5 years ago when you could only get health insurance, good health insurance, affordable health insurance through a group policy. If you weren't a member of a group, you were screwed.
Bill?
I apologize. apologize if we're jumping between different topics. But just to add to what Maddie and Meg were saying about base pay, I totally agree that it's abysmal and is a barrier to everyone having access to the position. The problem is that to solve an abysmal level requires a major jump up. And I don't know if we could pull that off as much as I want to. And so just from the interest of what can we do to actually solve it and not just put the number out there and then get completely burned, I think putting in the recommendation saying, we think it's abysmal, we think the problem should be solved, we think an independent commission of some form is the way to do it, perhaps moves the ball forward in a way that doesn't, you know, just puts us in a position of dealing with furious blowback from more tight-fisted folks.
When the person goes to the ballot in November, oh yeah, this is the measure that's going to double the city council's salary.
That's what they'll think.
So I was just trying to skip that jump. We all agree that it needs to be raised. But set it up in a formal mechanism. Put it there, out there in a commission, and let these commissioners, whoever they are, every 10 years, boom, this is what the salary should be. They have to pass it by whatever, two-thirds or half, I don't care, goes to city council, and then it can be recalled or referendumed. If people want a referendum, if people get really pissed off at that they want to pay the mayor $150,000, it can be referendum. So it's all there for it.
Steve, do you have the Sonoro language on your computer?
No. I can get it.
Can we get it by tomorrow? I would like to so we can hear the details of the two proposals just to make sure we, if we're going to go that direction, that we cover everything.
I'm going to send you mine and then you can put them on the same sheet if that's okay.
Dave, I'm okay with that idea. I would like to include some language that, as I said in my proposal, at least requires the counselors to vote on whatever salary and benefits they receive. This backdoor piggybacking on city employees, if they're going to do it, I want them to stand up and say, this is what we're doing.
In the commission, they have to vote on it.
Yeah,
they
that commission would be 2 or 3 years down the line? Or what's the time frame for these changes?
Well, right now, we are finishing up debate on the starting debate on the FY13 budget. This charter will pass, and we will begin debating the FY14 budget. I have suggested the fifth year, being halfway between the charters, to start the FY15 budget. So we're really only...
But this is a suggestion that we would make to the council, but it wouldn't be part of the
charter.
If they decide we don't want that.
No, I would put it in the charter, the compensation of elected officials.
Okay.
And this is the mechanism that we would put it in there and spell out whatever the language is. So the compensation for all elected officials will be handled as such.
Okay.
Boom. And whether we define that it's 9 members or 8 committee, I don't care the level of specificity that we'll get to tomorrow, but I just sort of feel that we put it in the charter, and then they have to abide by that. So I just sent the thing off to Steve. Steve, if you could circulate my sloppy language and the Somerville language, and then people can look at that as when they have nothing else to do at midnight tonight.
As long as it's on the City Hall right now, I'm sure. Maybe their ordinances are wrong. Yeah, their ordinances are wrong.
But if you can find it, that'd be great. And then we can move that forward. But I just sort of feel that that's a way to handle the charter. It doesn't become the lightning rod, which it could in November, even though I think we would have no problems here getting a vote to double the salaries of the school committee and the city council. Even if we didn't touch the mayor, I think there's enough people here who would support that.
But if, let's say, hypothetically, 2015 rolls around, proposal comes out to double the salaries.
Yep.
Council people get up and say, I can, in good conscience, accept this salary given the financial hardship the town's under.
Mm-hmm.
They vote it down, and we're still stuck with the status quo,
mm-hmm.
which is lacks transparency, lacks equity, and involves some conflicts of interest. Is that how it would work? If they vote it down because they don't want to go to the in front of the voters next election, having approved their own salary increases, what would we be stuck with? What's the default?
I'm kind of thinking about the equity issue a lot, and I'm not sure I'm going to be able to articulate this right, but the members that don't take the benefits, that's their option. you know? I don't see why.
It has no value to them. If you're retired and you're getting Medicare, you don't need it. It's got minimal value.
Great. I mean, good. You got it somewhere else.
But is it equitable to offer someone something that has $15,000 and someone else who maybe is single, not married, doesn't have a family, and has other insurance that has no value? Should some compensate?
Well, will those five members, I'm sorry, not be able to be on the city council if they don't get health benefits here? I mean, are those five members that are currently getting health benefits going to have to go get a full-time job somewhere else?
The example that I know of, and what I think animates me on this issue, without using names, it involved a council member who was on his spouse's insurance. When this person came into office, dropped the spouse's insurance, put himself and his family on the city's insurance at a cost of $15,000.
There was also Wendy Boxman, and her husband said, healthcare coverage is a big draw. You know, are you?
Maybe that's because of the compensation so low too. Right. You know, it's like what Megan said. That's that at least you can get that.
But I what I wanted to say to the principal is I wouldn't mind having a principal that city council service is not for the compensation. We recognize it as a minimum sort of just courtesy almost that the city does to thank you for your service. And not make a total hardship, but that it shouldn't for the money. And if health insurance is in there, and at least for the minute, at least for the moment, if the level of coverage that the city offers its employees would be a gold standard for some, you know, then you are making city council service for the benefits. You're not doing it for the virtue of public service.
Red and then Megan?
No, just what you just said. I was on another. I've worked for companies before that if you didn't take advantage of the benefits, the health care, they gave you other compensation. And that was like a gift. So, I mean.
That's my company right now.
Yeah.
Megan?
I don't think even if we did raise the pay or benefits that anyone would be doing it for the pay. I just think that amount of pay would make it possible for somebody to do it.
Something like healthcare and daycare are two important things to diversify, to bring in younger people on the city council and the school committee. And if they can use their compensation to help pay daycare and get healthcare along the way, you know, that gets another person in the door that may not be a voice that we've been hearing. Amen.
The other thing I would just say is that if we don't offer health insurance and part of that, you know, is that we think the person can pick up Commonwealth care, I mean, it's still a taxpayer-supported program. I mean, it's not like that's just coming out of the heavens. Yeah. I mean, we're kicking it basically to the state.
Yeah.
If we were to be able to set some very broadly worded principles in the charter while still passing this on to the independent group, we don't have to solve this. We can put the issues out to the independent group and direct them about the kinds of things they ought to be thinking about. Even within, let's say, the concept of fair compensation, we can include language that they need to think about the issue of fairness among council members, between council members and city employees, on issues of diversity and the differences that different groups might need in terms of defining compensation, fair compensation. So we can direct them without solving it.
Now, the only question I would have is that, does that go in the position paper, or does that go in the wording of the charter? And I think in the position paper you can elaborate far more detail and more specificity the concerns that have been raised. I think the wording of the charter I would want to make sure was tighter.
But the broad statements could be in the charter.
Yes, but I'm just kind of watching.
Recall or have access to what the current charter language is regarding compensation.
Now, the current charter in front of me, I don't think it talks about
it. It just talks about how to get the process of getting
doesn't set numbers. It doesn't set any of that. That's all set someplace else. And again, the concept of the commission was to establish something that met every decade that would look at this.
And again, the default, if the council voted down the commission's recommendations?
It's a good question. I don't know. And I would have to, again, when we look at this tomorrow, because we're at 8:13 at the moment, when we look at this tomorrow, we have to keep that in the back of our mind. That's the 100-pound gorilla on this issue. We have to sit back and say, yeah, what will the default be if we opt to this as an option? Again, we could do nothing. We could opt to the commission. We could opt to actually weighing in there and saying this is what the benefit and salary package should be. You've got that whole stretch in there.
A real quick look through the current charter, it looks to me as if the only, this is really quick, but I think the only reference is the city clerk,
I don't think there was a reference.
There's a reference that the city clerk shall receive such compensation as the city council shall determine. I don't know if that's repeated for all the officials, but it's very general.
I was just going to say, after all this, the council could knock it out anyway. You know, whatever we propose, they could just look at it and go, whoa, you know, this is too hot for us. They could do that. I mean, they can do that with anything.
I just think it's a way for them to recognize. I think they can accept what the commission recommends, but personally not take it, too. That's an option. You know, the Romney thing. I'll take a dollar for my salary for the year.
Would there be a way in this, in the language, to sort of include the default, which is that, you know, the council must take an explicit vote on compensation, including benefits, blah, 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 and then set the commission, so that if they don't embrace the commission, they still have to stand up in the transparency issue. If they want to give health insurance to 5 members and not to 4, fine. They're entitled to do that. But at least they have to stand up and vote in public on that.
Well, why don't you work out some language on that? I don't particularly want to get too far into the weeds on that, only because we're now approaching 8:15. And bring that back because we are scheduled to come in tomorrow. Now, let me just do my recollection of what's happened tonight. We have established or recommended the establishment of a commission that will look into election procedures, preliminary, etc., primary, whatever. We have voted against including free petition. We have voted the new language for initiative and referendum. We voted against recall. We have will be circulating language overnight about the elected officials' compensation. Did I miss anything else in my thing? The one thing I do want to... Signatures, thank you, which included signatures. Thank you very much. We did solve the signature issue. Okay. The one thing I do want to talk about before you all go, just so if there's a problem we can clean it up tomorrow, is we've talked about people doing papers and having those for next Tuesday. Who's doing what? Just so I have a sense of who's responsible taking on what, and then if there are gaps, those people who don't raise their hand get volunteered. Bill.
I thought I was doing council.
You're doing all the stuff around city council, the first section.
Yes, I want to take a piece of it, but I thought I was doing the whole thing.
Okay. Maddie?
I thought I was doing mayoral power.
All the issues around the mayor, all the changes of...
Except for that dovetails with his.
Yeah.
Who is the chair piece?
You.
Okay.
Whatever. Yeah. We can both do it and then merge them. The question that I had was, I'm sorry I left early on that day when you talked about how commissions are appointed, so I'm going to have to catch up on that.
So we can do that tomorrow when you go and start thinking about these things. If you have ideas or questions you have, tomorrow's could be the forum. I don't think we're going to need all 3 hours. But I think that's when you say, how are we phrasing this? Help remind my memory. What's the history I should be bringing in? I take Barry's point, since he's here in the room, that we do want to put in the pros and cons. We want this to be a full reflection of what we heard, not just a pushing one particular issue. We want to create a broad range here. And that was the intent of writing these position papers when we thought about this at the beginning of the week. And we referenced you particularly there. Mark, you were going to do
elections and signatures.
Yeah, the elections, the preliminary, whatever we decide on with all that piece. Okay, that where we set up a commission, while we're setting up a commission, the signatures. Okay. Okay. Gail, you are doing.
I'll do all the citizen access. Four. And what was I supposed to write?
You were doing clerk, and you two were doing something else together.
Yeah, we pulled a Rick Perry.
We can't remember.
I thought that the two of you were writing up a narrative around the election.
But he's writing about the numbers.
Oh, okay. Okay. I thought they got a special assignment.
Yeah, we got a special assignment for the commission.
Remember what?
For the commission. Okay. That's it.
It's
Thank
the
you.
Election commission.
So why we're setting up an election commission. And you're writing up about why the numbers are changing in the ballots.
Yeah, we're
Tom, you would also volunteer to do the clerk.
In terms of what?
That, just a simple...
Oh, you mean in terms of why it should be an elected position as
correct.
Opposed to appointment?
Hi.
Hey.
What was your big area?
That was about the absence of the mayor and so forth.
Absentee is the mayor, so she'll be handling that. And there was no discussion on it at all.
I know, I watched it on television.
Nothing came up. So at the moment, you're a freebie, but tomorrow there might be things we need to have filled in. Megan?
2 years, 1 year term.
Okay. And term limits were for the...
Unless they're doing that in theirs, in which case, I could just not have an assignment.
I mean, I'm just saying, as far as council terms go, it's going to change.
They want to take it out.
Right.
City council and for the mayor. There's some overlap here between you two and you two.
I don't need to do this. I just thought we were doing the talk that we did on the
correct.
Tonight, and that's why I
just want to make sure we're clear on this.
Good. I thought I was just doing what I did at the presentation.
Preside or not to preside, right?
Was presiding or not presiding over the two committees.
And I'm just doing the term and term limits. Unless somebody else wants term limits.
And are you then going to pick up vacancies? How to handle the vacancies.
You did see the mayor with
me. I didn't do the vacancies.
Do we need to?
Yeah, that didn't come up.
It was actually no change, right? Exactly.
Well, there is a change because we have a vice council president.
Right.
I guess that would be.
That comes under you.
Okay.
Okay, so you're escaping so far. You're doing good.
Okay, I'll tell you what, I'll bring coffee.
There is a change with a permanent vacancy. We changed that.
Right.
We did.
We don't have the city.
I don't know that we need a narrative for that.
But with the mayor vacancy, wasn't the issue that there wasn't any specific time? Singapore President becomes acting mayor, a special election set if more than 6 months from the end of the mayor's term. But that isn't specific in the charter.
It was a gray area that got people uncomfortable, so we have defined it as 6 months.
Oh, so we, okay, if you have to.
Yeah,
we
discussed
that. Yeah, so that's there. So you're still our designated pitcher, hitter, whatever, the guy runs around the bases when the guy hits the ball. So tomorrow, in case there's other things. Right. So tomorrow, if you have questions from these areas that you'd like some more background on, please come forward. I'll also be working with Bill on creating that overriding narrative that we're going to put on that I'll either read or hand out Thursday night,
right.
Which will be similar to the press release.
Right, I was thinking I was going to have to dress like tonight to get that done for tomorrow.
Yeah, and I'm just going to steal it with my.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you're going to do one narrative. You're going to do one narrative.
We'll do
one
narrative.
All the others will be pieces.
Here's the suggestion.
Okay.
Is that there'll be one narrative that will be presented along with the document on Thursday night. You don't need the document until actually 5 o'clock on Thursday. Your position papers would be needed to be to her by 5 o'clock on Thursday.
The whole thing.
We don't have any except for I'm running the overriding narrative, and he's our free catcher to pick up anything that we dropped.
So
what's missing?
So here's the question. We're going to meet on the
Tuesday.
On Tuesday to play with the narrative. So
right.
Can people have their narratives to each other by Sunday night? And then I wonder if it makes sense for one person to take all of them and just for style and format, pull them together so that it's a narrative that follows the flow of the charter and is usable. You know, so we're all using the same tenses and that kind of stuff. Is that a reasonable thing to do?
It depends if you define that one person to be. I will not be available at that period of time. So I need to take myself off the table knowing what I have to do next week.
Okay.
So
something I would generally be happy to do. It's possible I won't be able to be here on Tuesday. But if that didn't preclude me from being the smoother outer after Tuesday, I could do that.
Okay, well, let's play that as a question mark for tomorrow to talk about. But what I envision is, again, having this document, which would include not only the charter, but these proposed pieces, that I would then stand up at that podium and say, we did our work within the time frame you know. This is as far as we got. This is what we were able to deal with. These are things we were not able to deal with. Here are some of the major recommendations. Thank you very much. Goodbye. Okay?
Handing them all of them, so you're not going
to... Yeah, they'll get it in their packets when they
right.
sit down. They don't have to read it. They don't have to vote on it. All they have to do is acknowledge that they have it in their hands and we met our timeline.
Yeah, I would just like... I just think it presents a better... package if the seven narratives don't look like seven separate things. It looks like we're all connected to all of them.
I'm happy to edit for style.
Again, let's sort that out tomorrow.
Okay.
Okay. But I agree with you. And I think that there should be kind of a structure to it.
Okay.
The same font. At least. Okay. We're there. Anybody else have questions or comments that they need to bring up at this point in time?
What goes on tomorrow?
Tomorrow here?
Tomorrow.
We're going to take a look. He's going to get us the whatever we've got approved up until now. We're going to do basically an overall final approval of what we have approved in the charter. Okay, we've approved bits and pieces, but we want to start getting to the comprehensive vote. We are going to discuss position papers. We're going to ask if there's anybody who has questions about how they want to write their position papers. You might, want some background or some language that you want to put in there. And then we will adjourn. I do not believe we will take 3 hours tomorrow.
Okay.
All right? And then you'll go home, you'll do your homework?
No,
we didn't. So we still have compensation, we still have a couple of others.
Correct,
so
and compensation, thank you.
And a couple of other issues that are...
Loose ends. Is that all right?
And so this probably answers the one question that I had. When we talked about full consensus, which we had on a lot of issues the first couple nights, assuming that when we circle back it all holds, but Mark wasn't here. He's now here and he'll be here tomorrow. Will he have a chance to, are we going to circle back on everything so that he has a chance to add his voice to, so that we can really say we have full consensus on
As he's gasping over here, he's having a heart attack. I appreciate that. As someone who's trying to run this meeting and get us done on time, I will talk with Mark about, does he have any strenuous areas that he feels a need to talk about? I do not want to go line by line by line by line. We did that. That was how I used you folks, seven people, eight people in the room, professionally. You know, Mark had a conflict. That's unfortunate. I do want his opinion shared in here. When we talk about writing position papers, that's where Mark could share, you know, his feelings about things. But I want to not go back and start all over again on this. We don't have the time.
I just want to process clear because it has a gap.
And Gail, when we talk about having consensus, I mean, that doesn't mean that everybody like fully endorsed, right? Like we can describe like, oh, there was intense debate and people were on different ends of the spectrum, but we all agreed to disagree or whatever. It's not like it was a 100%, you know, there were a few issues like that, right? So consensus is just a broad term.
Or alternatively, are we using the word consensus to imply that there was agreement, stronger agreement than perhaps there actually was?
There were a lot of issues on which we all did agree.
Total agreement, yeah, I would say. But then,
and some where we had enough agreement that people said, I won't stand in the way of going forward.
And I think the position paper should articulate
right.
that.
Yeah.
You know, I think right. that's why particularly I want that one written, because that was the tough issue. And we need to sort that out.
On the election.
On the election piece. You know, because that was a
burner.
I mean, I took some notes as we went on that, maybe Mary did too.
She's been writing your laundry list over here. Thank you. I motion to adjourn.